1690 WVON.
Now you official now, but you got a soul to say. I just been cooking that note. I'm about to drop in the field. Think if I call it the great, the people gonna call it the truth.
Bismillah Rahman Rahim, brothers and sisters, we are back. You're listening to Straight Words on the historic WVON 1690. This is the talk of Chicago every Tuesday evening. We've been coming to you from 9 until midnight with some talk that you've been needing to hear in your ear every Tuesday. We hear, brothers and sisters, Black Strong, unapologetically pro-Farrakhan, Straight Words, with your host, Brother Naba'a Richard Muhammad, the editor-in-chief of the Final Call newspaper. Assalamu alaikum, big brother. How you doing?
Wa alaikum salam, sir. How are you?
Brother, I'm doing good. Back in the place to be.
Sandwich. Yeah, we're glad to have you back, man.
Yes, sir. I'm glad to be back. Sandwiching between two icons. Of course, our other great brother. He is a former editor of the Final Call newspaper, now contributing editor. I'm talking about Brother James G. Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum to you, sir.
Wa alaikum salam, Brother BJ. It is so good to hear your golden voice back on the airways, man. We miss you, man.
Praise be to Allah.
We could feel the absence, brother.
Brother, I'm glad to be here, man. Of course,
man.
I've been having some great shows, and brother, I've been checking in with everything, man. Praise be to Allah. We're back together again. So
We got to hear about
you. We're back together.
Yeah.
Sir.
I said we got to hear about what you had to go through at some point, man.
Woo! Yes, sir. Right, well, we'll get into that when y'all want to talk about it, but I'm just glad to be here. Praise be to Allah.
He needs some counseling, Brother James.
I've been traumatized.
He needs some therapy first, man. He can't. Well, Brother BJ,
got a taste of the wrath.
Oh, man. Lord have mercy.
Okay.
Well, Brother BJ, we're blessed and honored to have you, the Hall of Fame, Black Radio Hall of Fame broadcaster himself. Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters. We hope that we're going to have a good night tonight. We hope that it will be an interactive night. Because tonight, we want to talk about not only memories of, but lessons from the historic 1995 Million Man March. One of the greatest moments in the history of Black folk in this country. And one of the largest gatherings in this country, regardless of who called it, Black men.
Yeah.
Convened by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. We're going to have Brother Charles Abdul Wali is going to call in from St. Louis Brothers. And he's going to talk to us about an incident that happened with an off-duty Black police officer who was beaten by some white folk. So we see, man, and this is not unusual. We've had undercover Black officers shot by white officers they were in the police academy with.
Right.
While they were wearing the color of the day, because when you're undercover, you're supposed to wear like the color of the day. So if they roll up on you, they can kind of, you know, see that you're one of them and not one of the people they usually just beat up.
Yeah.
This brother was beat pretty badly, man. So Brother Charles out of St. Louis is going to bring that to us. Had a couple interesting media appearances today. I must say, with Donald Trump and Kamala Harris. Pretty interesting. Y'all want to start with either one of those?
Yes, sir. Go ahead and get into it.
Yeah, I got to say, I was going to say, tell me about them because I missed them both. I've been running, so.
Okay, Brother BJ, you go ahead. You start.
What do you want me to start with?
Why don't you start with Trump, man? Let's start with him.
Well, you know, we've been watching and trying to read up on his cognitive issues, right? Everybody's talking about that now. I was looking at the Drudge report, and they were calling him Psychotic Don. And it seems like he may be cracking up. Psychotic. Yes, psychotic Don. And it seems like he may be losing some of his cognitive issues and concern because they had a rally the other day, and they said for like 50 minutes or so, he started just playing music and playing a DJ, and he stopped taking questions from some of his Republican supporters at this rally where he was doing a question and answer. And they say he's just kind of losing it now, you know?
Well,
yeah. Yeah, it was really weird, man, when you see the it was really weird when you see the video. So he's having this rally.
Yeah.
And at the rally, apparently a couple people get sick, so they bring in the paramedics. So, you know, he's been kind of doing what he does, basically ranting and raving, you know what I mean? And then, so he stops, they say, to allow the paramedics to take the people and take care of them. But brother, that doesn't really, not for 38, 40 minutes. It doesn't take that long. So he's up there, he's, dancing and they singing YMCA, you know, it's just very strange. And the interesting thing is that the very thing that they were throwing at Biden.
Yeah.
They're now throwing at Trump. Like,
yeah.
Does he have the cognitive ability to be president, man? So it's a very, very interesting situation, you know. It's really interesting. So he was in Pennsylvania, and it just went down like that, man. So it's really just kind of weird. So that's been all over the media the last couple of days. That's been, and I think even you know, Kamala Harris kind of went after him for it today.
Yeah.
She posted on X, "I hope he's okay." So this is really something happened.
Do you think that's going to make any difference in, you know, give a bump to Harris or make any difference in the polling?
I don't think so. I don't think so. I think because the people that like Trump, they don't care what he does.
No.
The people that don't like Trump, whatever he do ain't going to change their mind. I think the question is...
But they got the fence straddlers, the you know, people who are... Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, but I don't know if that... I mean, if that changes your mind, right, to not vote for this man with everything else that he's done,
maybe the
cumulative effect, maybe. But, I mean, to me, it was kind of interesting. It was kind of bizarre. I don't think it's necessarily a deal breaker, brother. PJ, what do you think?
You know, I've been trying to keep up with what Kamala Harris is doing. She's done some interviews. She did a good interview with Roland Martin. She did a good interview with Joe Rogan. She was on the Howard Stern show. And she's kind of trying to show everybody that she's like an everyday Joe type of black woman. That she drink a beer with you and, you know, shuck the job with you and all that kind of stuff. But as far as people's excitement about it, I just don't see it. I see a lot of, what do y'all think about this thing about, is there really a groundswell of black men who saying that they're not going to vote for Kamala Harris? I mean, because you saw what the former president Barack Obama, when he scolded the brothers about, you know, y'all not going to vote for her because she's a woman?
The thing that, Rick, first of all, I don't think it's true. I don't think Trump is getting 25% of no black male vote, period.
Right.
Matter of fact, it's not even saying that anymore. Because I was watching earlier, they were saying that at one point when it was Trump-Biden, they polled black men 25% for Trump. Now, since Kamala's gotten into the race, that fell to 12 or 13%. That's really not outside what others have kind of done, other Republicans, it's in the neighborhood, maybe a little less, right?
Yeah.
Than what Republicans were getting from black men pre-Obama. Obama had such an appeal that he drew many of these black men back to the Democratic Party. I think that there is a frustration among black men, but the Democratic Party has been losing black voters for years.
Right.
For years.
Yeah.
They've been losing black voters for years. And the other thing is, I'm going to say this because a brother said it finally today. I was like, thank Allah. He said, they asked him kind of this question. And he started by saying, well, 80-something percent of black men vote for vote Democrat, right? So the overwhelming majority of black men vote Democratic.
Right.
And then, so to me, to say black men, no, you're not talking about the majority of black men. So why are you using that language?
Right.
And I think the more they use that language, the more there's a chance that black men are not going to come out to vote. And it ain't got a damn thing to do with supporting Donald Trump. It's got to do with the go ahead, Brother James.
No, I say, but, and I, two quick things. If there is a number, a minimal number in a critical state, if you combine that with some of the other votes, such as the youth vote and the Muslim vote, who are dissatisfied about the Gaza issue, then that could, you know, in a very tight race, could potentially swing a state, even though there may not be that many black men that's going to go that way. But if there's a large enough number that once is combined with other disaffected people who have declared that they are not going to vote, that could be a bummer. And also, it didn't help to me, in my opinion, the way, as you guys just mentioned, President Obama addressed the brothers who aren't going to vote in a condescending kind of way that could, you know, I don't think that really helped to draw people closer to her, as opposed to maybe another approach might have even kind of helped to change some minds, you know, to come to vote for her, even though they had initially decided they weren't. So it was those two things, I think, right?
Yeah, and the other thing is, not one vote has been cast yet. You're talking about polls. Remember the big red wave that was supposed to come in 2022?
Yeah.
Republicans in control of the House and Senate? That ain't happened in no way. In no way. But let's put a pin in this. I think, do we have Brother Charles Abdul-Wali on?
Yes, sir. We sure do.
Let's bring Brother Charles in. Everybody else, hold on. Brother Charles.
Yes, sir. Assalamu alaikum.
Walaikum salam. Hi, this is Brother Charles Abdul-Wali Muhammad from St. Louis Real STL News. Hi, Brother Charles. Tell us about this news, man. About this off-duty brother being beat by these Caucasian people.
Yeah, so this off-duty cop went through a construction zone. The construction zone was not clearly marked. There was a construction zone. So when he came to the zone, one of the guys had stopped him. His name was Matthew Devlin. So after Devlin stopped the cop, they haven't released the cop's name. He got out. They got to a verbal altercation, and he actually hit the cop with his hard hat. You know, the construction, what they wear.
The white construction worker hit the black off-duty officer with a hard hat.
Yes, and then two other workers, Garrett Gibbs and Donnie Hurley, came over there and assisted the other co-worker while they were beating black cop. Now, while they were talking, Devlin called the cop the N-word, told him to go back to the hood with your gold chains, and you didn't belong down here. So he was in the south suburb of St. Louis. You know, there's more whites down there, more so than blacks. So I guess he felt empowered to tell the cop. Well, he didn't know he was an off-duty cop at the time, but he saw a black man and told him this. Now, what was interesting is that they held him down, and then they beat him again with the helmet. And then they choked him. They almost choked him out. He was saying that he couldn't breathe. So they kept doing that. So somebody came by and called the police. Now, to add insult to injury, the cops listened to the white guys, actually detained the black guy. They talking about he was drunk. They took him through a field sobriety test, kept him in handcuffs, and then once they finally figured out that the white guys were lying and that he was a St. Louis cop, you know, he had been detained, humiliated, and, you know, stood out on the construction site for all people to see. Now, what's more vivid than this was this incident happened September 26th. Charges were not filed until October 11th. Now, what makes it more interesting is on October 6th, almost in the same area of St. Louis, you had neo-Nazis above the highway. They had their flags, and they were marching, you know, with their outfits on and everything, and they had signs saying this is the white man's country, you know, and they had that. So these people are emboldened now.
Yeah.
So also, the guys have been charged with first degree assault and armed criminal action and kidnapping. Michael Devlin, his bond was at $250,000. Bonds for Garrett Gibbs and David Donnie Hurley was set at $100,000. Now, they had a bond hearing today, which bond hearing got denied. Their bond reduction got denied. So, we got a hyperbole in this, too, which came out of nowhere. So, a good friend of mine got a kite from a birdie. So apparently, Matthew Devlin, about 10 years ago, worked at a Five Guys Burgers and Fries restaurant in one of the St. Louis suburbs. So we obtained some paperwork showing that he got fired for being racist, creating a hostile work environment, and not filing company rules. It was about four or five people who filed reports against him saying that he was racist, was always yelling at the people, made it very hard for them to go. One person said he kept writing them up in an attempt to get them fired to get up out of there. One conversation he had with a hiring manager, he said, I heard you had an interview today. He said, yeah. He said, was it a black person or a white person? They said it was a white person. He said, good, because there's too many blacks working here. So this guy, Matthew Devlin, has a history of being racist, and he was fired for that. Now, how did he get
Brother Charles, I want to get back to this case, because we're only going to have you on for a certain amount of time. So who has been charged with what? Has anybody been charged with anything at this time?
Yes, they have been each charged with first-degree assault, armed criminal action, and kidnapping.
Okay.
Today they refuse to say that this falls under a hate crime, even though you have the history of him using the N-word and that witnesses said that he called the black officer the N-word at the scene.
Okay. Okay, so now what's next in this illegal drama playing out?
So as I mentioned today, they went for a bond reduction, and the bond reduction was denied. So they'll go to court and probably get, put in jail until court time comes. But I spoke with the president of the St. Louis County NAACP. He's pressing the St. Louis County Prosecutor, Wesley Bell, to upgrade to hate charges, and I think Wesley will not do that. So he said he may have to go to the Department of Justice to have them look into this case.
Okay. Well, Charles, thanks for calling in. Tell the people how they can follow you and how they can see your work, where they can see your work.
Yes, you can see the journalistic work on the New Real STL News on Facebook and Instagram. You can follow me at Charles Abdul Wali Muhammad on Facebook, and you can follow me at Abdul_Wali73 on Instagram.
All right, bro, Charles. Thank you. So keep us up to date, and we'll stay in touch. As-salamu alaykum.
Yes, sir. Wa alaykum salam, sir.
All right, let's go to the phone. So we got Brother BJ.
All right, brother. We got Brother Barney then hanging on. As-salamu alaykum, Brother Barney on WVON 1690. Straight words.
Wa alaykum salam, family. How are you? Praise due to Allah. A mighty subject today on the Million Man March. I wanted to first mention the interview that was going on. I don't know. I might have missed what you mentioned. Did you mention Charlemagne the God had the...
No, we haven't talked about that, Brother Barney, so you can lead right into it.
Yeah, CNN. And it looked like they really post that up pretty good. Charlemagne the God was interviewing Vice President Harris. And he asked some really in-depth questions. And, of course, he didn't get the kind of answers that he wanted. One of the questions I was most interested in when he set it up for her to answer the questions about whether or not she would deal with reparations.
Right.
And she came mainly with information of things that they had done holistically in certain bills and things of that nature, but never really, from my opinion, addressed that issue. So hopefully, you know, and I've noticed that they're really putting a lot of emphasis in marketing her with men, on pictures you see with a lot of black men. And so forth, and then these photo ops that I see with these black men. So we have to be very careful and watch it on how they do that. I also wanted to talk on the Million Man March just before I go off. You know, it was a beautiful Holy Day of Atonement presentation that was done on Sunday. I suggest that everyone get that presentation down at Mas Mariam, because they went through the whole rendition of our sister from student regional.
From Atlanta?
From Atlanta. Oh, she brought the
fire.
Captain.
And she
went through the litany of things, of results of the men going to the Million Man March. And it was one of the first rare times that they did bring up Reverend Devils, as with that he who had given the minister that theme of atonement. But one of the things I wanted to mention on the Million Man March is that, you know, one of the things that the messenger had given to us, that, you know, judgment could not fit until all had heard it. And I looked at the Million Man March as one big orientation, Nation of Islam orientation, where that you had every aspect of the black community represented there. And each one of those brothers took back to their places of abode the name of the man of God, the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. And that's all they needed. And they went back to the byways, the highways, and the lounges, and the traps, and his name was mentioned. So I see 10 years later, we begin to see the effects that nobody can say they didn't hear. So that was the aspect of the Million Man March that I saw. And I think a lot of it, we had an opportunity to have that. Well, I thought I'd just chime in with that, brother.
Go ahead, Brother Warren. Thank you, brother.
May Allah bless you all, brother. Keep up the good work. And again, please support this station. And let's get together and make sure that we grow from here.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Brother Barney.
As-salamu
alaykum. As-salam. All right. We got Brother Cliff. You're on WVON 1690. You're on Straight Words, Brother Cliff. Go ahead and talk to him.
Yes, assalamu alaikum, brother. Thanks for taking my call. Hey, listen, just wanted to simply say that I went to the Million Man March, man, a beautiful thing. And then just listen to the last segment with the Brother Ishmael. And I'll get right to the point. And basically he just said, in terms of this country, regardless of the vote, that this country is going to be destroyed. It's going to self-destruct. and that will be by the wrath of Allah. So there's nothing that we can do. You know, so under Trump administration, it's going to go to hell faster. That's what he said. But either way, it's gone because of basically how they treated the black man in this country. Matter of fact, since the beginning of time, Brother Ishmael was saying that the wrath of God was coming down on America. God gave America a chance to repent, but it hasn't done that. Even as the black people, he's given us instructions how to repent. We haven't done that. So we're going to suffer. But, you know, I would simply say this is that, you know, thank God for Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and you brothers from the Nation of Islam. And I'm just simply saying that, you know, when it comes down to black people, okay, and number one, the hatred for black people. And just let me say this and end by this and get your opinion, right? The assassination attempt, right, on Trump. Now, just recently, Trump said, he made a comment, I just love black men. Black men are my brother. I just love you people. Do you guys recall that? This was recently.
Yeah.
You can Google it, right? So the point I'm making is that you got white supremacists, right, that hate black people, and Trump is their leader. So the point I'm making is that if Trump is now campaigning saying that he loves black people, so my point is that these three attempts, right, they've been done by white people. So maybe, you know, the fact of the matter is that he's catering or even talking about loving black people, that his own people are turning on him and might take his life. I'm just saying, you know, I'm just putting it out there just as a thought. So the point I'm making now, if that does happen, that will even bring more chaos to this community, to this country, in terms of if this dude gets his ass. But for the most part, black men do love him. I don't know the percentage, but he's saying that. So the point I'm making is that how would white people, white nationalists, white Nazis, how they're responding, you might see more attempts. So, again, going back to the minister, he's saying how this country's going to implode, even with the hurricanes coming. You know, brother, this is going to be a tough year. We've already seen the devastation. This is just the beginning, but all praises to Allah. And I'll end by saying this. I made my donation, so keep up the good work, brothers. Assalamu alaikum. I love you, brothers. Much respect.
Thank you.
Much respect, brother. Thank you, Brother Cliff.
Yeah. I think Trump will say anything that comes to his mind, brother.
Yes, sir.
You know, anything that'll make people clap.
But I will tell you this, though. I have heard this from brothers who were formerly incarcerated, because I know during his administration, a lot of brothers were let out of prison because of the policy change that he did.
The
First Step Act. And I have heard brothers say, well, what's wrong with voting for Trump? Some of those brothers that got out on that first step back. So I have heard that for real.
Yeah, and I heard a recent interview with Kwame, the former mayor of Detroit, where he was, you know, mentioning that it was Trump that got him out. What's Kwame?
Kilpatrick.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't think, Cliff, you got to worry about white folks turning on Trump because he said he loved the Negroes. They know what that's about.
Yeah.
Trust me. They know what that's about. That's about using us as a tool and also a slave. Because I would ask the question, what has he promised black men?
Right.
And if anybody got an answer to that, please tell me or direct me to what he got. Now, Kamala Harris laid out some stuff today. She laid out some stuff today about supporting businesses. She laid out some stuff today about home ownership. She laid out some other things in terms of wanting to focus on black male health. Now, and she also said about reparations, she said that needs to be studied. But what ended up happening, Brother BJ, the brother who asked the question added a part on that let her off the hook, right? Because he went straight to it at first, like, what's your position on reparations? Then he went into something like, in light of what we suffered historically, da, 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 da. So she said real quickly, reparations need to be studied. She said that real quick. Then she went on to talk about the historical stuff. And, you know, she also said that, you know, of course, because the brother was like, and Charlemagne asked her one point, and there were a couple questions that led her to respond to the idea of whether or not, or basically how much could she advocate for Black people was kind of the thrust. But the questions, because they said, well, you got to be the president for all the people. She said, yes, I'm running to be president for all the people, but that doesn't mean I'm going to ignore realities. There was no follow-up to ask her, okay, what does that mean, policy-wise, right? And can you even target anything specifically at Black people? So if you say you're not going to ignore realities, I think the next logical question is, how do you change those realities? What policies? And the Supreme Court has knocked down anything that's a race-based or seems to be race-based or connected with race or hints at race. They knocked it all down. The corporations have turned their back on diversity, equity, and inclusion. So, brothers and sisters, you better come together and separate.
Nothing.
You ain't getting nothing. We got anybody else calling?
Yeah, we got J.A. Salam on the line, WVON 1690.
Oh, that's
Chicago. Pretty good. You're on Straight Words.
Too, man.
J.A.
I was just thinking about you, Brother Salam, because brother was on about that article.
Yeah, Salam Alaikum, Brother Naba.
Alaikum Salam. This is Brother Salam, one of our contributing writers to the Final Call, and my protector and caretaker when I was in Ferguson, man. This man took great care of me, brother. Him and Brother Ricky. Brother Ricky, if you out there, I'm shouting you out, man.
Yes, sir. First off, I just want to say, you know, I thank Allah for the opportunity to come on your call. I've been listening in just a few minutes, and, you know, very interested right now. Of course, I knew we were going to talk about the Million Man March, and that just, that day, right? And that day was just so beautiful. But you just touching on that Kamala Harris, now you know all this stuff that's going on. But, brother, I just want to say, first off, going back 20-some-odd years ago, I want to pause and give a shout-out to our beloved brother, Ishmael Muhammad, on that message Sunday.
He represented.
Yeah.
Brother, didn't he? You know,
yes,
so I just wanted to just say, you know, to my brother, he did a phenomenal job, and the message is very timely. And but at the end of the day, I think it's very important that we, as a people, recognize that during that time of the Million Man March, it was a time that people saw us Black men in a different light. They've never witnessed anything like that. But I was just sharing with someone this past Friday on the next morning. I don't know if you recall this, brother. The news from D.C. had their cameras the very next morning, and they were showing the mall how clean it was.
Yeah.
They actually show how clean the mall. They said it was as if nobody was here. They was all these people here yesterday. And today, look at the mall, and they had the camera on the mall. There was no trash, no nothing, nowhere.
You're right.
Go ahead.
You're right, bro.
2 million Black men, no fussing, no fighting, no cursing, no drinking, no smoking. Hold on. No trash?
Brother Salam, day, when I left the mall, I left kind of late off the mall, and my clear recollection was looking out over the mall from the stage, and it was like that old Western, how you see just clear land and the tumbleweeds every now and then would blow across. And that's the way it just seemed like a tumbleweed would blow across. It was so clean, and everybody had left, man. It was remarkable.
Yes.
Brother, that has never happened, not just the men gathering,
But that has never, brother, you can't never. Get that, get a trash free carnival. I mean, come on, we could you walk down the street.
You got to think too also about the people who stayed back home. What was it like in the small towns or in the cities where you know, masses of men just kind of got up and left, and you know, and the spirit that they left with, and you know, and the children they left behind who were observing that day, many of whom may have been observing that day.
Yes, sir. I remember we had an office in St. Louis, headed up by our dear brother, international representative, Brother Minister, Brother Akbar, and I was working with him side by side with his special assistant. So I was like right there, we got T-shirts, we got this, we got that. And I remember we chartered four planes, and we had over, I want to say 50 or more buses, and it got to a point, even on the radio, they were on the live radio throughout St. Louis, brother, our stations, was asking anybody, do you have any vans? Do you have this? We got people who wanted to go, and we need to pool, we need to carpool. Do you have a van? Do you want to go to D.C.? That's what was happening, because it was people who couldn't get on the buses were gone, the planes was already filled up, and that was, hold on, check this out. How about $75 a head?
Go ahead.
We negotiated $75 a head, brother, to fly to D.C. and back, okay?
Wow.
And back.
That's 1995. Do you hear me? So wow. It was an experience beyond one's imagination. And so someone asked the question, what would be the difference? What would you say is different then than today? I said, well, today we have the internet. We have all these things that's going on. And like in the relay race, and just think about this for a moment, you know, it's four people that's running. The one in the front takes off and he has the baton in his hand and he reaches back to hand it to the next one. I look at that analogy as the generations. And even though you're reaching back, the one who's behind you has to be reaching forward. And the question comes down to, after we have done that long ago, many of our youth today, many of my people, wasn't even born. If you're under, even if you're the age of 30, you was only one. You know? So think about that, and then think about what are we passing on? And right. Are they reaching more? They're not reaching for what we have for them. Okay.
And Brother Jay.
Yes, sir. Go ahead.
You remember what the cry was? Long live the spirit of the Million Man March.
Yes, sir.
And we got to bring that back in every city and every nook and cranny.
Absolutely.
America, because that's the only thing that's going to save black people is the spirit of the Million Man March and what was put in them black men. We got to revive that spirit.
You know where I was going, because, see, we got to, that was so profound, so powerful, so inspiring, and it touched the masses of our people in a phenomenal way. We can't let the media, who have silenced the image and this and another, it's our responsibility to build it in our spirit and be talking about, once again, long live the spirit of the Million Man March. What did it represent? And how can we bring that back that our children and our grandchildren, great-grandchildren will not forget it? We can't allow them to silence something of that magnitude. That's like trying to blow out the light of the sun.
Right.
So I just want to give my two cents worth.
Beautiful, brother.
Thank you, brother, for calling in. And man, thank you. Good to hear from you, Brother Salam.
Good to listen in.
You know, brothers and sisters, we're talking about the 1995, October 16th, Million Man March on Washington, convened by the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan. The themes for the march were atonement, reconciliation and responsibility. This gathering was unlike any in the history of the country in terms of its size, its scope. The participants were Black men who came from across the country and were supported by Black women who helped organize the Million Man March, who led a voter registration effort at the march, and who inspired and supported men who wanted to come to the march in terms of us atoning for what we had done that was wrong, reconciling with one another, reconciling with our families, and taking responsibility for the future of where we would be as a people. So this was not a march for jobs and justice appealing to white people. Even though the minister, when he spoke, he called on the government to atone for its sins, right? That it had committed against the American people, period, let alone against us. So that was the call, part of the call. But the main call was to us, because at that time we were really slaughtering each other. We were the ones causing the problem among us. Even though the enemy may have created conditions, we were being agents of our own destruction. Right. So this march and this effort called for us to stop that. The march was held on a Monday, unheard of. Usually when you do an event like this, you do it on the weekend. It was held on a Monday. So you had to miss a day of work, right? It was also, the minister instructed the brothers as he toured the country for over a year now, organizing this. He said, one, if you can't afford to pay your own way, observe it from your house. Because he said everybody had to sacrifice something on that day. This was not somebody else paying your way. How was that responsibility? Right? He said to the brothers, don't bring your weapons. Don't bring no drugs. Right? So he was calling for, and by Allah's grace, setting the parameters for a certain type of mindset and a certain type of spirit that permeated this 10-hour plus event from sunrise all the way until in the evening when the minister spoke. This effort was broadcast live over CNN. Matter of fact, if you go to C-SPAN right now, or if you Google Million Man March C-SPAN, you can get it. Or if you go to store.finalcall.com, you can get it. And you can see for yourself. And what Brother Salam was talking about was a great message that Brother Student Minister Ishmael delivered yesterday at Mosque Mariam in Chicago. Mm-hmm. And that message is available at NOI.org. Again, yesterday, Sunday, message by Brother Ishmael Muhammad, and it was a really beautiful message, and one that you gotta hear it for yourself. And the title of the address was Atonement and Repentance. Who of the presidential candidates can save the lives of the people of America from the wrath of God? You can get that at NOI.org. The Million Man March was not funded. It was not supported by the national civil rights organizations. It was not. It was not supported financially by labor unions. It wasn't supported by nobody but Black folk. Black entertainers kicked in. Black people kicked in. We had a special edition of The Final Call that we sold for $2 to raise money. And all around the country to do that. And then brothers organized themselves as well to come to the march, because the minister was looking at the trashing of the Black male image. Our children, remember now, they were being called super predators.
Right.
The crack cocaine and the drug epidemic was in full effect. Gang violence was raging across the country.
The O.J. Simpson verdict was coming in around that time, if I recall.
That's right.
Wasn't O.J. Simpson right around that time.
It's in June. Yeah. That's right. Right a couple of months before. Yes, sir. They thought OJ was going to show up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, I didn't. But anyway, I won't get into that. Interestingly, I mean, and this was Muslim, Christians, Hebrews, everybody all together. Not one crime committed on that day. Listen to what I'm saying. Not one violent act committed on that day. So we're going to continue to get into this. And we're going to continue to share with you. But we're not just going to go down memory lane. That's not what this is about. We're going to talk about what are the lessons for today.
Yes.
These spiritual values of atonement, reconciliation, and responsibility. Do we need those today? Because those things and that atonement theme is not only a theme of the march, but it is a process that the late Reverend James Bevel, a comrade and lieutenant for Dr. Martin Luther King, gave to Minister Farrakhan that was woven into the march. So we're going to talk about
that atonement process.
Yeah, master strategist for Dr. King. So we're going to talk about that. And we're hoping that you will call in if you're male or female, if you win, if you didn't win, if you have questions. Want you to call in so we can have a great conversation. I think we're off to a really great conversation. And I think it's really probably no more fitting time than now when there is a focus on black men. And black men are being portrayed in a certain way. So we have some good stuff to talk about. Brother BJ, I guess we got a few minutes before we take the break.
Yes, we got about 4 minutes. Do you want to squeeze in a call real quick?
If we have one, we can squeeze in 4 minutes. Absolutely. Let's get them.
Okay, we got Brother Art on. And Brother Art, we got just a couple of minutes, so go ahead and make your point right here on WVON. Welcome to the show, sir.
Hey, good evening, brothers. You know, I find the word, yes, sir, so I'm like, interesting that yes, sir, we use Hillary Clinton used super predator. And we find ourselves...
Speak up a little. Speak up a little.
I said we find it interesting the former president's wife said the word super predator. And we find ourselves right now in our community when you just hear on the news that a man that had cancer, somebody broke into his apartment and his... I think his sister was taking care of him, and she found him bludgeoned to death in the bed, and right over there, over east, over there, close to where the mosque is at. But we find that our community is in horrible shape, and I hope and pray that we can take what's past and somehow make it present. Because right now, I think there's a huge disconnect. I hear a lot of our commentators. We dwell over Dr. King, Elijah Muhammad. We dwell of all the men and women that came and did what they did. They even rolled in Jesse Jackson Sr. up still in a wheelchair trying to get him to be relevant. And somewhere along the line, we have missed it because we shouldn't have to wheel men and women who been working all this time in wheelchairs to get our community going. So we got to figure out a way how we're going to re-strengthen the black community, the black family. And I think, again, I continue to say, until we come universally with the code of conduct and the family value system that all parties can agree on, and the same energy that we put in for the Million Man March and the same type of resources and money and time and energy, that same platform has to be done presently today. And as I said again, I charge those who say they are leaders and teachers and those say who wants to be in front of black people, somewhere along the line, they have dropped the ball because our community is in terrible shape, the black family, terrible shape. And I'll leave you with that and what now, black people.
All right. Thank you, Art. And we're going to have on later people that are engaged in that work right now. That's what I said earlier. this ain't about a walk down memory lane. But I'll say this. There's a penalty that you pay for rejection of divine guidance.
That's right.
But we have to continue, Brother Art, as you said, we have to continue to work and make our mark. If you're not doing that, you're not a great follower of these great men.
Right.
So on that point, I think you got a good point. Go ahead, Brother BJ.
All right, top of the hour, brothers and sisters. We're talking about the Million Man March 29 years later. What are the solutions? How are we going to resurrect this spirit? We're going to get into that conversation. But you can support our show, brothers and sisters, straightwords.com, straightwords.com. We have all the information on our website that how you can support us, and we would love for you to do that. And we've been on the air by the grace of Almighty God, by your support. So keep it up, brothers and sisters, straightwords.com. Coming up, more Straight Words on WVON 1690. This is the Talk of Chicago.
Hey, this is Matt McGill. When I was 7 years old, I lost my mother to breast cancer. All I can say to all my sisters out there, I love you. Get a mammogram. Think pink.
Breast Cancer Awareness Month is powered by Equal Hope. Get the support you need for a healthier life. Call 312-942-9368 or visit equalhope.org.
The Talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
I'm Vanessa Tyler.
And I'm Mike Stevens on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
It's go time.
He is too weak and unstable.
Vice President Harris and Donald Trump pulling out all the stops as more polls show a dead heat, a virtual tie in this neck and neck to the finish line.
The day I take office, he's finished.
Both candidates spending time in battleground Pennsylvania, a must win as Harris continues her media blitz with plans to go on Fox News. And she taunted her 78-year-old adversary to let America see how he ticks.
He refuses to release his medical records. I've done it. Every other presidential candidate in modern era has done it.
Kamala Harris says her housing affordability plan will help generations of Black families.
When we address it by doing things like helping folks get their foot in the door with a down payment assistance, they will have the ability to be on that track of intergenerational wealth building.
In an exclusive interview with BIN commentator Roland Martin, the Democratic presidential candidate said Black folks have been denied the chance for home ownership due to a number of reasons. Harris says one of the main drivers is that neighborhoods are being systematically undervalued by real estate appraisers. Part of her plan includes up to $25,000 in down payment support for first-time home buyers.
This close to election day, and polls show there are some Black men still not on board the Harris train.
I intend to earn the vote of everyone, including Black men.
Which is why her appearance on The Breakfast Club with Charlemagne the God in a town hall style event with questions from Black men is crucial, a constituency where Trump brags he's made some gains.
Black men, I love Black men. I love them. I love them. Gone through the roof with Black men. Black men. I don't do quite as well with Black women, I must say.
Those who were there telling Fox 17 the homecoming horror near TSU.
I heard gunshots and I took off running.
I thought it was just fireworks, but it ended up being gunshots and everybody was just running. And I started running, almost fell. Thank God it wasn't me.
Tennessee police aid was a shootout near the HBCU in Nashville Saturday night when two groups pulled out their guns. One person, ID'd as 24-year-old Vonquay Johnson, died. Nine others hurt, including a 12-year-old. Police still trying to figure it all out. They say those who may know something are refusing to cooperate. On social media, stay connected with the BIN on Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok at Black Information Network. Catch us on X at Black InfoNet. I'm Vanessa Tyler with Mike Stevens on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
It's Matt McGill.
I'm going to be nice about how I say this. Now, on Facebook Live, there is a young lady named Trish Gates who just said on our Facebook Live page, slavery is over. Stop talking about damn slavery. I'm glad you're on WVON Facebook page and listening to the show. With all due respect to you, I am going to just encourage you to never say that again. I am so tempted to say so much more. Either you have lost your damn mind, girl. You don't know who you talking to. This WVON, girl. You don't talk about slavery and you white talking over there, man. You lost your damn mind.
Weekdays at 1 p.m. on the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
It's all about great food and service at Let's Eat to Live Restaurant, located at 621 East 67th Street on the south side of Chicago. Fresh, healthy, life-giving meals prepared with love. Veggies, fish, chicken, lamb, burgers, soups, breads, delicious desserts, and more. Some coming from our on-site garden in season. We got good food for your soul at 621 East 67th Street. That's Let's Eat to Live Restaurant. You can stop by or call us at 773-966-6549. Or visit the website, letseattolivecafe.com.
Hi, it's Tavis Smiley inviting you to join me weeknights, 6 to 9 p.m. right here on WVON. I'll bring a national perspective to all things happening in Black America. It's talk the way you like it, and it's why America is listening.
It's the legendary Tavis Smiley, weeknights at 6 p.m. on the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
Discover the captivating world of Black art and history at AfricanWorldArt.com. Are you seeking a unique and meaningful gift, or do you just want to come celebrate the richness of the Black diaspora? Our online gallery is the place for you, with a wide selection of paintings, sculptures, prints, posters, and more. Journey through time with images that document our triumphs and challenges, from present-day icons to ancient civilizations, as well as the struggles of slavery, resistance, civil rights, the Black Power Movement, and the Black impact on sports, entertainment, politics, and global justice. AfricanWorldArt.com is more than just an online store. It's an inspiration drawn from our experiences. Visit AfricanWorldArt.com or call 267-312-4189. That's 267-312-4189. AfricanWorldArt.com. Since 1985, it's where Black fine art and historical pictures come to life. That's African spelled with a K. AfricanWorldArt.com.
Tune in every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. for Speak On It with Dr. Kofi Malik. You've seen him on cable TV. Now hear his spirited conversation on the Talk of Chicago. The question at hand is raising voices of the Negro. That plain and simple. Tune in every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. for Speak On It with Dr. Kofi Malik on the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
Got a three, got a two, got a one. Yes!
Tune in Friday, 9 to midnight, for The Fundamentals, where I, Titus T. Dub Williams, bring the mental.
Thanks, Captain Obvious.
And I, DJ Turbine Arturo Garza, bring the funk.
Are you not entertained? Is that why you are here?
So if you want some wacky,
some good conversation,
but some fun,
and a little serious,
for all your sports needs, tune in to The Fundamentals.
Friday nights, 9 to midnight. We'll see you there.
You like that? You like that?
Life and power drives our weekly talk show, Straight Words, on WVON 1690, The Talk of Chicago.
This is Naba'a Richard Muhammad.
This is Brother B.J. Murphy.
This is Brother James G. Muhammad.
Tune in Tuesday nights, 9 to midnight, for real Black talk. It's Straight Words.
On Straight Words, we inform, we educate, and we have a good time.
Black voices speaking on the Black struggle for freedom, justice, and equality, and bold defenses of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam. This Tuesday, 9 p.m. to midnight, Central Time, on WVON 1690 AM and WVON.com. And go to our website, straightwords.com, for more content. We're Black.
And we're strong.
We're unapologetically pro-Farrakhan.
Hey, Alexa, play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
The views expressed on our programs are not necessarily those of WVON, Midway Broadcasting Corporation, or our participating sponsors.
The following is paid programming. The views are not necessarily those of this station. We are the talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
All right, brothers and sisters, we black, strong, unapologetically pro-Farrakhan. You are listening to Straight Words. StraightWords.com is our website. You can go check us out. We're on WVON 1690, the talk of Chicago, every Tuesday night from 9 p.m. until midnight. And when you go to our website, you can find out all the information on how you can support us financially, because we do need your help, because we're paying to talk to you on the radio every week. And we love it. And we've been doing it for a year, brother. We going on. We about to make our anniversary coming up in, I think it's in March that we started this show, and we got like are we about 2 years. Wait a minute, hold on, brother.
No, we'll be 2 years.
2 years.
We'll be 2 years in next year.
Wow.
In May, yeah.
Isn't that something? May, isn't that something, brothers and sisters? And we've been doing this because of the love that you've been showing us. This is incredible. Man, that's beautiful. So straightwords.com is our website. Go there, brothers and sisters. And we got a special text line if you want to make a donation on our text line, 312-480-9775, 312-480-9775. Brother Naba'a Richard Muhammad, Brother James G. Muhammad, Brother BJ. We are here with you on Straight Words, and we got some phone calls, brothers. We got Robin on the line. You're on WVON. Go ahead and talk to us, Robin.
Hi. Assalamu alaikum, gentlemen. How are you?
Alaikum salam.
Alaikum salam, okay. My sister.
Hey. Yes. I hope I make sense with my comments. There were three categories of three things that I heard you all talking about. And the first one was the spirit of the Million Man March. The second one was about passing the baton. And the third one, I don't know that you necessarily were talking about, but it was something I want to say about slave syndrome, post-traumatic slave syndrome. And I don't know how many of you have heard about that. There's actually a book, and it may not even be in print because it was, I think, about 25 years ago that the young lady was selling her book that she had written. It's not a very long book, but I'll start by saying that I think the ills in our community stem from slavery. I think anything that you can point to within our community stems from coming from enslaved people. And I'd heard somewhere where I don't know how true this is about the Willie Lynch papers, but all of the strategies that were employed to keep us divided and distracted was understood that if they did that, it would last 200 years. And here we are, not 200 years, but a friend and I at work were saying that it's going to last another 200 years. And I'm going to go backwards because now I'm going to talk about the baton issue. I think the reason why it appears as though we're not passing the baton is because the people behind us can't reach forward and get it and grab it. And the reason why I say that they can't is because there are too many distractions. The cell phone. I'm a public school teacher, and the students did not even complete their work in my class today because it's a self-paced program, a reading program that it's not one where I lecture and we talk and we read and we write. It's one that's set up specifically for the student to do their own work and to move through the program. I just decide which assignments to send them. And their primary assignment has to be done, but then I can supplement that with other assignments. They had 90 minutes. And after those 90 minutes, the majority of them had not done any assignment. And when you are in that position as a teacher, you look out and what you see, everyone on a cell phone. Everyone on a cell phone. It's an epidemic, not just in Black schools, it's nationwide. And if you Google some of the articles about what we can do with the cell phone or what we need to do in public schools about the cell phone, they are a major distraction. And I tell my students, I said, this is keeping you from understanding life, understanding what's going on in the community and understanding current events and politics and all of that, because they're not on their phones reading those kinds of things. They are texting each other. They are, I've even had students talk on the phone, FaceTime people in the classroom on their phones. And as much as you tell them, put the phones away, put the phones away, put the phones away, they can't, because it's become a matter of being addicted to their phones. So we can't get through to them. And I don't know. I mean, I'm quick to think about conspiracy theories. But I think that this could be all part of that conspiracy to keep us numb and to keep us unaware and to keep us distracted. And our children are distracted. And the other thing is, they have a lot. They have, sometimes I feel like they have too much. When I was growing up, girls didn't wear weave. Girls didn't have long, extra long nails. They were little girls. You know, they didn't have the accoutrements and the latest, you know, they had little fashions and things. But you can see a child walking down the hall, and they have, you can look at them and see how much of what they have on. You can say, wow, I know that child has on a day's pay, you know. And that's what parents are doing. They're allowing some parents, well, I can't say all, some parents are indulging their children with these things and not thinking about the impact that the cell phones and all these other distractions have on their children. And then we're going to have a generation and of what we don't want. But let me say to you about the Million Man March and how it impacted me in such a positive way. My son was 8 years old, and his father worked for Xerox at the time. Now, at Xerox, during that time, I don't know if it was a diversity effort or what, but they had a minority group of male, female minority group. And that minority group, that African-American group, were given the day off if they wanted to attend the Million Man March. They were paid. They were given that day off. Someone at the job coordinated the trip from Baltimore, and we live in Randallstown, but they had to get to Baltimore. I don't remember if they went by train or if they went by bus, but Michael was 8, and his father and I decided that he could go, that he would go. And I'm glad that they went, because it's a part of history. There's a calendar from all the pictures that were that they took. Those pictures were turned into a calendar that I still had. And I still have the newspaper that covered it, probably was the final call that covered it. Still have that. Still have pictures of my husband and my son holding the African-American flag. But what made the biggest impact on me was when they got home at 11 o'clock, you would have thought that those two had won the Super Bowl. They came all the way from D.C. through Baltimore to Randallstown. And I know that was at least an hour. And when they came in here, their faces were so lit up and they were grinning ear to ear that they had done so much for them. And I know it was one of those moments where they were able to bond. Michael was even excused from school, so I'm not sure his school was happy about giving him a lot, you know, giving him, but he had an excuse after to do this, as long as he made a presentation, and he did. He made a presentation, and one of the teachers said, well, was Farrakhan there? You know, and he was like, yes, he was there. You know, he spoke. But it was just an experience that I'll never forget, looking at them, that I know they'll never forget. But they were so exhilarated, you know, when they got home. So I hope I didn't take too long, but those are the comments.
No, that's fine, Robin. Thank you for calling in.
You're welcome.
All right.
You're welcome.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Great.
Okay. Let's go, man. We got anybody else on the line?
Brother Shaheed is standing by. Brother Shaheed,
assalamu alaikum. Waalaikum salam.
Brother Shaheed, how you doing, man?
I thank Allah. I'm just taking it all in, just sitting here listening. I have my guest on, our brother on, Brother Johnny Harvey, and we're just taking it all in, just sitting back listening and smiling and the whole wop. So I like to start with the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. I bear witness that's no God but Allah, and I bear witness Muhammad is a messenger. That million man march just shook me as she was talking. Because we were all there. I can remember being around just about each and every one of y'all, us, and there was a lot of us. There was 2 million of us. It wasn't, we called it the million man march, but it should be called what it is. It was the 2 million man march.
Yes, sir.
The white folks, it wasn't up to 400,000, you know, because you know how they lie.
Right.
We got that coming.
Right.
So I don't know if we want to start because I want to talk about a double hitter here, Miss Martha Harvey, who's Johnny Harvey's the brother that's on with me. It's his mother. She's turning 100 years old tomorrow, or we should say the day when the sun set for the Muslims, the day already came in, but we'll just say 12:01. She will turn officially 100 years old, and that's huge in our community in this day and time. But what makes it so huge, all y'all know Brother Shaheed, and a lot of people on the fault line around the world know me. But they probably wouldn't have got a chance to know me if it wasn't for the Alan Elijah Muhammad. There was a lot of other people in my life. But Miss Martha Harvey and this brother here played such a crucial impact on my life that anybody know me, they have to know them. So we're going to honor her tomorrow, and I just wanted to put it out in the community, let Johnny come on. We done worked about 4 or 5 radio stations this week, also last week. And I told him we were going to be on there. Johnny, can you jump in there with me for a minute? And then I can come back to the Million Man March if I have time, if y'all give me time. But I want to definitely cover Miss Martha Harvey, a person that we stayed with. There's about 16 or 17 of us in the house for 3 years. And it was time for us to move. She did not, his mother, did not want us to move. And when we did move, they came, you know, helped us for another 2 years. So me and this brother are blood brothers. You know, we're straight blood brothers. Johnny, are you there? Brother Johnny?
Assalamu alaikum, my brothers. I thank you for taking the time.
Alaikum salam.
Wow.
I just want to thank you,
Brother Johnny.
It's Brother Shaheed. You know, he always expressed.
Brother Johnny,
still there?
They might have accidentally hung up, brother. Okay, yeah, we lost him.
Okay, Brother Johnny, Brother Shahid, call back in, okay? Call back in. We got anybody else holding?
No, sir. Not right now.
Yeah, I was saying, I'm hoping that we hear from Brother Andrew of We Our Us in Baltimore, and this is an effort that's going on right now in the streets of Baltimore with the aim of lessening violence right there in the streets of Baltimore. And part of the inspiration for what Brother Andrew is doing is the Me and Man March, and they're actually going to have a commemoration of the march tomorrow dealing with young people. So this ain't just having old men come in and talk about, do you remember? No, this is about talking to these young men who they work with on the regular, right?
Yes.
Giving them a sense of history, giving them an image of black men being in peace and harmony with one another, because brothers and sisters, some of our children, they ain't never seen that.
Right.
They ain't never seen it, basically. All they've seen is conflict. For the most part, maybe out, you know, in their family, maybe not. But they've been taught a view of the world to look out for yourself, to look out for yours, and don't worry about nobody else. Right. So many of them have been taught.
So, brother, that brings up.
Go ahead.
I was going to say, I was going to hitchhike off what you were saying, because Sister Robin, when she was talking about how her husband and son, when they came back to the house, their faces were lit up, and they probably were overwhelmed by being in the presence of seeing other black men in love with each other, and they never thought they would witness something like that. And that's what you're saying with our children. If they could be around us and seeing the spirit of the Million Man March and how we love each other and how we care for one another, how we would lay down our life for one another, just being around that changed your whole disposition.
Yeah.
And that's what the black community need. They need to see that.
Yeah. And she also talked about how, you know, young people were disengaged in school and not turning their work. But what I also think is, you know, it's that because young people ain't challenged by something. They're in there and they're doing their own thing because they're not challenged, especially if it's a situation where they're just given an assignment and that's to themselves. But if you incorporate, for example, with the Million Man March, if on their phones they were looking at that image of the Million Man March, and there was a conversation asking little Johnny, hey, what do you see when you look at all these black men? Or, you know, just probing them for reaction to an image on their phone, which they're already into their phone, make them use what they love and put whatever you're trying to do to give them through whatever they love. Like if they like rap music, talk about history through rap music. And, you know, so it's ways to engage young people. But especially in this day in October, if something like that was happening in our schools, that would definitely
be a way
for us to get the Million Man March to our children.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, and we got Brother Enoch Muhammad. I'm hoping to hear from him.
Yes, sir.
He's with Hip Hop Detox right here in Chicago. And they will be having a program about the Million Man March at Chicago State University tomorrow. And again, they'll be dealing with young men that they deal with on a regular basis. So all of this, brothers and sisters, as remember now, remember the themes: atonement, reconciliation, and responsibility. Those are all things that begin with us.
Right.
They don't begin with nobody else. They begin with us. So everything that we see that we feel needs to be corrected, it's up to us to go to work on it. And I think we've seen time and time again that, you know, there's a place for the political process, but we've got more black elected officials today probably than we've ever had in history. Why isn't our condition changing? Because we're going to take something more than the politics of this world.
Exactly.
So the Million Man March was not coming to be incorporated into the politics of this world, but it did have an impact on the politics of this world, right? It had an impact on the politics of this world, because one of the things that the minister said to these black men that were being awakened, responsibility, making your communities better, you know? So let's get Brother Anthony and his guests back in here, and let's continue with their what they have to say to us.
Okay, I'm sorry. I'm not sure what happened. I was talking, and then I asked you something, and then you didn't answer. So I don't know what part you heard.
We heard brother starting to speak.
Okay.
And then he dropped off. We didn't hear anything.
Oh, wow. Johnny, you need to jump back in here.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, go right ahead.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So as Brother Shahid said, this is an honorable occasion. I just like to say to all the brothers and sisters out there, we need to take care of each other. We can't keep looking for the white man to take care of us or anybody else to take care of us. We got to take care of each other and God to take care of us. And just to be able to have a mother at 100 years old and for me to be there to serve her, which it kind of shows you the teachings that she had, the things that she did for the Shahid family, you know, and made us all one family. That teaching was passed down to me. And I was able to do for her what she did for others. And to make those sacrifices, what it takes, my brothers and sisters, we have to make sacrifices of ourselves, of our flesh, of our being. We gotta put it down. And we got to say, hey, we got to do this for one another. We got to do this for our mothers and our brothers and our sisters. We got to honor our women. So my mother had a fantastic caregiver. Those are the most unappreciated. You know, we talk about the first responders, the firemen, the policemen, and all that. Hey, you know what? I honor that too. But let me tell you something. There's nobody better than these home caregivers.
Yeah, gotcha.
They are the most unappreciated people on the planet. I could not have taken care of my 100-year-old mother without my home caregiver, Miss Rita Reed. She may not realize it, but I'm going to adopt it, even though she's only 7 years younger than me. I'm going to adopt it because this is something that I truly, truly have a passion for. As I see our sisters, you know, they walk out here in them uniforms and those smocks and those things, and we just look at them and we kind of blow them off as being, you know, not important. Without them, nobody would be taken care of, including the white folks.
That's true, man. That's true.
I mean, you think about it. The things that you and I as men and our mothers and sisters as women, there are certain things they just don't want us men to be involved with when it comes to their personal care.
Mm.
And those women step up to help us in that area. I definitely have been blessed to have one to help with my mother. Without her, it would have been a little difficult, a lot more difficult to get to this point.
Mm-hmm.
Right. But I will share this with you, brothers. I had a corporate job, and I got laid off that corporate job. And when I did, my mother got sick. And I took care of my mother for 2.5 years. Before I got another job. And at that time, I was in my late 50s.
Mm.
And I got another job when my mother got back up to health. Then, just 4 years ago, I got laid off again. But that's okay. Because guess why I got laid off? To take care of my mother.
Go ahead.
And the time that she needs me. I didn't care nothing about that job.
Go ahead, Brother John.
But I took care. It was an honor. I work every day. She is the queen. There's
That's
nothing
right.
that I won't do to give her. I lost 40 pounds running for her. And I mean, and let me tell you, I love her. She's a diva. She's a diva. Brother Shahid knows.
She's a real deal now.
Whatever she wants, she earned that right.
To
be 100 years old, there's nothing she cannot have.
That's right.
You know, if I gotta get in the car and drive to Chicago today to pick up something up, guess what? I give me some coffee and I'm on my way.
That's right.
Good.
So that's why I say, you know, we talk about all these things. And I look at how we treat each other. And I shake my head of how some of our sisters who look at their mothers and treat them a certain way. Mm. They don't realize that's going to be them someday.
Mm.
You know, I saw a lady, and I mean, and it kind of tears me up a little bit, but I saw a lady in the store. She wanted to buy, the mother wanted to buy a pair of shoes and a dress. It was about $20.
Mm.
The daughter stands there. This is her daughter. And she stands there with Gucci bags and had a Mercedes outside.
Wow.
And said to her mother, "Do you have enough money to buy that?"
Wow.
I'm standing there, brothers, and I'm telling you, I literally had to pray so I didn't go off.
Mm.
And she snatched the dress from the lady and she took it back. Mm. And the lady got to the counter and she didn't have enough money. I say, "Hold up, I got this.
Mm.
Let me buy this for this lady." All she wanted, it just took me to my mother.
Yes, sir.
You know, and I'm standing to my, and I looked at this woman, and I tell you, I prayed that I didn't say anything, but I walked out the door and I was just buying everybody. I could not put it down. I still can't to this day. How can you treat your mother this way?
Mm.
So we got to love each other. Some of you all may not have your mothers anymore.
You teach on that now.
Right.
I'm blessed to still have mine. And I'm willing to share mine tonight with you all.
Wow.
Because it's a beautiful thing to know. And I tell her all the time, I say, "We've been celebrating you happy. And Brother Shaheen know what she says." That ain't nothing.
So do. She so do.
You can tell her all day long that she took care of a family of 16 people in one house. A husband, my father, my mother, and my seven brothers and sisters, and Miss Mary Smith and her six children, all in that house. And we had no idea that we were struggling.
That's right.
Mm. Wow.
So I ain't lying.
To hear what I hear today when people say, "Oh, I can't do this," and the white man, you know, at the end of the day, and Brother Shaheen, no, I've been in that corporate world. What I learned from you brothers on the street, I went in that boardroom and did.
Hmm.
And it worked like a charm.
My white boy.
So to think that you got to be something else? No, all you got to be is together. All you got to do is know, first of all, that Allah and God loves you.
That's right.
Yes. Mm.
And then there's nothing you cannot do. And but I take no credit for anything that I have done positive. It goes all to God. And all that I do goes to God. And everything I do bad, guess what? I blame me.
Mm.
I can point the fingers at everybody else, but at the end of the day, I knew what I was doing.
That's right.
So we got to get that mindset and understand that what I'm doing is what we all should do. And we can talk all day, and I tell Brother Shaheed all the time, I don't know how to sugarcoat things either, but I didn't do it in the boardroom either.
Mm.
To hear you brothers honoring, you know, willing to take this time to honor my mother, I tell you, it just does my heart great. I just tells her about it, and I'm going to tell her about it first thing tomorrow. And the first thing she said, "Oh, is that really?"
Absolutely.
You know, and that's how she takes it. And again, I'm just, I'm happy. I'm joyous in about, What are we talking about here? In another 90 minutes, she'll be 100 years old.
That's
That's right.
Mm. And she knows that. And she and brothers, I want y'all all to know how good God has been to her. She still lives by herself.
That's right.
Mm. Wow.
Right. That's right.
Yeah. Now, I will tell you, every time, and Brother Shaheen, I'm there every day. But every time I leave that house, I realize that I'm walking out and I'm leaving my 100-year-old mother by herself. So I say, God, she's in your hands. Anything I can do to help, I'm here. But that's a blessing, guys, and I appreciate you.
So that's the reason we're doing October the 16th through the 19th, because it was so deep. Miss Martha Harvey's birthday, and then the Day of Atonement. What kind of bigger blessing can you get? So we have so many people coming out with us tomorrow to honor Miss Martha Harvey on the 16th, but we're taking it from October the 16th to the 19th, because believe it or not, my mother's birthday is on the 18th. And she's been gone already 20 years now. So, of course, Allah gave us that opening opportunity. And I thought about, you know, tomorrow I'm going to fast, because that's what I was doing 29 years ago. I'm Louis Farrakhan asked us to fast. Mm-hmm. You know, he told me to show more brotherhood and to do some things. You know, so, of course, I'm going to be pushing that. I'm just going to be pushing everything that we did during that time. But the only thing tied into us, what the nuns have told us, go out and help somebody. But I'm going to help somebody who didn't help me. If it wasn't for her, I couldn't even get no help.
Very big ahead, man.
Elijah Muhammad. And it wasn't for the Messiah. If it wasn't for Miss Martha Harvey, it's some other people, but I'm talking about who played major roles in the structure of my life and my brothers and sisters. I don't believe we would even be on this farm today, because I think I would be dead. Or someone being a straight Negro. I'm just being honest. Or some wind up Negro looking for white folks to pat me on my head and give me some crumbs.
Yeah. You know,
that ain't going to happen. So I'm just thankful for this day. You know, I'm thankful that Dr. Salam will be there tomorrow. So he'll be covering it from the final call there. And, you know, we'll get something in there. And the mere fact that y'all let us come on. Miss Martha is so special to me. I can't explain. She's my mother. I don't have my physical mother, but I really do have my mother, because Miss Martha, I have a mother. And to know that she's 100 years old and she's by herself, but Johnny's over there every day, and every time he calls me, he know I'm coming, and I'm coming running. Right now, I'm supposed to be going to go overseas, but I can't go overseas. I got to be here with Miss Martha. Everything happened overseas. That's fine, and I love some people over there, but them people wasn't there with me when I was 3 years old and 4 years old and 5 years old and close to 6 years old. Gave me a place to stay. Who gave me a place to stay was Miss Martha Harvey and the Harvey family. So that's why this brother means so much to me, and y'all mean so much to me, and we mean so much to each other, because that's all we have. We don't have nothing but each other, you know. And unless we see something different than what I see, the messenger say, if we come together, we're more powerful than an atom bomb. So that's the only way we're going to straighten that out. It's come together in unity and everything else, you know, stop. Everybody respect us. We do that. You know, and the example is what the messenger did. Elijah Muhammad showed us the example. He showed you how Islam would clean us up, and it cleaned us up, and it still cleans us up. But you got to take a step to Allah and ask for Allah to help you. You can't just think. Allah said in the Quran, never do he change the condition of a people until you first change what's happening in Surah 13, I believe it's verse 8 or either verse 11. You don't change the condition until you first do something. So, brothers, I'm thankful to Allah that y'all let us come on. I don't know if you got any questions you want to ask Brother Johnny, but I'm just excited, and I love you. And I told John, he had been on a few radio programs with me. He said, hey, but hey, I'm kind of liking this now. I said, they're right.
Yeah, he good. He good.
He's a
nappy. Praise be to Allah. Praise be to Allah. Well, Brother Shahid, Brother Johnny, thank you. Please give your dear mother our love and our greetings, and happy 100th birth anniversary. Oh, that's a beautiful thing. You know, I don't have my mom, but I'm glad, always glad, always happy to pay tribute to a mother, because that's how I honor my mother, you know. But thank you, brothers, for coming on.
Thank you for having me, and I'm perfectly willing to share mom with you, too.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, hopefully we do get a picture of Miss Martha and send it to you, because, you know, hopefully Allah bless us to do a good little story tomorrow. And I like that, you know, the picture that you send, Johnny. You got to give a good picture of Miss Martha so the whole world can share. And that might be one of your statements, sir, that you're willing to share your 100-year-old mother with the whole world.
Yeah, that's beautiful, brothers.
Beautiful.
That's so really beautiful, man.
Well, now a lot bless you and everything. Happy Day of Atonement, brothers and sisters. God, for us, the sun is already set, so it's already October 16th for us.
Yes, sir. Hey, Brother Anthony, you want to mention anything else about the march, your experience that day in D.C.? And what do you think we can learn from it? What do you think we can learn and apply today from yesterday?
Do the same. See, you don't have to recreate the wheel. Just do it. You know, everything that we do dumb, that day wasn't nobody smoking. Just stop smoking.
Right.
That day wasn't nobody getting high. Stop getting high. Wasn't nobody taking nobody money. It had at least be 40 or 50 blocks, no exaggeration, passing money to each other all the way to the front in that one fight. I'm going to tell you, it's a tragedy that this million-man march or two-million-man march, that we should stop calling it a million-man march. Call it what it was, two-million-man march, that it's not in every history book in our house. We're not worried about the white folks pushing it. But it shouldn't be a black nation that's not pushing it, because that was what you call a miracle. A miracle that you could do with 2 million men. The minister took damn near a year going around from city to city to talk to black men and say that he's going to call a million-man march and call for 1 million, and 2 million of them came. And he gave everybody a chance to speak. But at some point, people got tired of hearing everybody else. They started saying, we want to hear from Farrakhan. Y'all doing too much talking. This is what we want right here. The minister came in, and he laid everything down from a pledge and told us, let's pledge what we're going to do. Let's go back and do what Johnny said. Be good to your parents. Be good to your wife. Be good to your husband. Because some of the people came anyway. They didn't supposed to come. But you see, that many men here, we coming. You know?
That's right. Some didn't show up.
To see the men clean up like they did so much. I'm going to tell you something else they don't talk about. That captain was taken by the Muslims, because them brothers up there wouldn't listen to the Capitol Police. They can Google this stuff. They had to turn it over to the Supreme Captain at that time, at that particular time, Abdul Sharif, and ask them to help get those people in place, because they were taking over area. Because them brothers who said, man, hell with y'all, this our day. And when they came to Captain Sharif, the Supreme Captain, and said what they needed, he told the brothers, hey, go out there and let them know they can't be in this area. Before the brothers could ask, they moved. So at some point, they had to tell the man, the capital belongs to y'all this day. Y'all are in control of it. And it was so deep that before we left, it wasn't a piece of paper on that mall. I think we had lost one life out of 2 million people. That was from a heart attack. And I believe Honorable Farrakhan went and visited that person. That's what you can learn from that, just by telling what happened, because it was a miracle. If you talk about the Martin and Watson, which was good with Dr. K, I'm not knocking none of them, but what would you say about this one when you get 2 million men that came, and when the sun came up, think about how that prayer came up.
That's right.
I can't call it like this. I'm going to leave that. That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to let y'all hang up on the phone with the phone call drop. But the world heard that prayer, and that prayer was so far. And you know what else was deep about it, brothers? Because you really hit me now. Every city, every plane, you couldn't get a plane in no city. You couldn't get no car, rent a car. That was over. Everybody was pushing people, saying, let's carpool. Who got an SUV? You got to drive your SUV from whatever city you were in. If you was in Chicago, you had to drive it because you couldn't rent no cars. You couldn't get on the buses. All the buses were taken around the whole entire country. All the planes were taken. All the trains were taken. Everything was taken. So brother said, well, I don't give a damn. I have to walk. Whatever way I got to get there, I got to get there. That was a heavy thing. And then to be on those buses and trains, I wound up coming up, you know, way ahead of time, because God blessed me to help the minister asked me to work in the city, to work in the street. So I worked in at least 20 cities for them. But the report with all these people, when they got on the planes were jam-packed. And brothers were just saying, long live the spirit of Million Man March. They weren't saying it like that until we got there, and that's when the minister really hit them. But that's really what they were saying. That spirit was like no other spirit. And that spirit needs to be rekindled. All we got to do is just, it ain't nothing hard to do. Just do what we doing, like you said. Go back, start with your mama. Go back, starting with your children. Go back, starting with the next door neighbor. Go take all sorts of trash out. Say yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, to a little brother 4 or 5 years old. That'll make him say yes, sir, no, sir, to you. And just clean yourself. You shouldn't be around there smoking cigarettes, smoking loud. And most of the stuff y'all smoking got y'all doing all kind of crazy stuff. Anyway, instead of a woman take her dress up and show her behind to the whole watch, she smokes them. That's something you shouldn't be smoking no more.
Right.
That's what that meant to me, brother. So I could talk about this all day long. I don't need not one notice from me talking about the nigga that morning. Because what it did. And then me say, I was very blessed. I was just blessed. I was able on October the 17th, the very next day, be with the minister for about 4 or 5 hours in a room with every guest that was coming, because people around the world was coming saying what happened the day before, which was October the 16th. They were saying that the very next day. And I got probably about 10 or 15 pictures up there with the minister. Because, of course, you know, I was trying to take pictures. You want me clicking some pictures, because that day was so deep. And then to go downstairs and let the white folks say that they thought we had 350,000 to 400,000 people. They specialize in being straight liars. They can't help it.
Yeah. And they stopped announcing that. They stopped estimating as a result of that. Because when they announced it over the loudspeaker, a big boom came from the crowd.
Yeah. You know? We had many people on the mall when the sun came up at 5 o'clock in the morning.
That's right.
These people, some. And then, see, the thing that they do, when the Quran said they cast doubt in a strong, firm,
evil suggestion and a firm resolution.
So what they just do, they just put it out there, and you there, you say, no, it's 2 men. No, y'all did good, but they said about 300,000 to 400,000. No, it was 2. So what he say is what they're ruling with. And then they'll show a clip maybe when we're cleaning up, or maybe during the morning when the sun first came up with 300,000 people say, no, but I'm sorry, though. It wasn't no more about 300,000. He said, I'll be damned. Well, I'll be damned. You know, because I'm a lies Muhammad, he's a master of trick knowledge. So all we got to do, brother, nothing to say when you got a rotten apple. I'm a lies Muhammad, nothing to say when you got a rotten peach. Don't throw it away. Don't throw this black man's black woman away. Take that rotten seed out and replant it, and you'll have a brand new fruit. And that's what they see when they see the fruit of Islam. They see a brand new fruit. We jump from jump out. We're the same with the brothers and sisters in the street. Allah just blessed us to change our life. And as Johnny said, we've given it to God. We're not perfect. We're trying to be upright. We're not telling nobody we're perfect and holy, but it's a difference in how we look and the difference between y'all look, because you can't keep getting high every day and smoking and drinking beer and eating pig, feeding pig ears and chitlins and everything. And look the same as a man that ain't doing it. It's just common sense that it ain't going to, you're not going to look the same. And we ain't bragging, but I mean, you bring that on yourself.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm.
So, brother, I love you. I love to talk about the Million Man March, and I'm so thankful for the relationship that I have with you, Brother James. I'm so happy the relationship I have with Brother B.J. Murphy. Mm-hmm. And you, Brother Naba, I absolutely love y'all. And y'all know that we have genuine love for each other as brothers.
Love you too, brother.
Love about this brotherhood in our hearts like this. And this brother on the phone, Johnny, I can't even describe how I feel about him, because what his mother and him did, but they bonded us so tight. You know, he's not Muslim, but I don't give a damn what he is. He's my blood brother. And if you come at him, I don't curse anymore, but you done messed up. Let me just put it like that. Now, you about imagine what I was saying while I was cussing. That's what you just did. If you come at him, you done declare war on me. You can't come at them. You know, and he's just a good brother, and he takes care of his mother. He loves his mother, so it makes me love him. Johnny, once you get a closing word, because I talk so much, I talk in my sleep. Won't you close with Johnny, please?
As I said, brother, I appreciate this. I'm loving all the love that, you know, you're showing to my mother and to my family. And I just want to be able to share that love with everybody that can hear us talking, that God loves us all. God is with us all. Give God all the glory, all the credit, and love.
Yeah. And Brother Johnny, before you go, though, I just wanted to mention what you said about the home care workers is absolutely true, brother. I used to be a communications director for a union that is a lot of home care workers on there. And they are the salt of the earth, especially during the time of COVID, and when everybody was calling these low-wage workers the essential workers and how much they love them. But these brothers and sisters have to sweat and fight for a little bit of insurance and a little bit of a pay raise, but yet they do what you just described. So I just want to say, brother, you're absolutely right about home care workers and other workers who provide services that are often overlooked in good times.
Yeah.
You know,
absolutely. And I will say that somehow, and what gets me, our brothers out there that that date these young ladies and these women, and they treat them so bad. You know, I've seen it, and it just breaks my heart. If there's ever something I can, I'm praying to be able to do something for those workers, because they deserve it. I'm tired of hearing about the policemen and the firemen. Yeah, they do what they do too. But we completely ignore the salt of the earth, and that's what those women are.
Wow.
All right. Beautiful. Thank you, Brother Johnny. Appreciate you. Assalamu alaikum.
We love you. Love you. Assalamu
alaikum. All right. Love you too. So, Brother BJ, what I want, Brother Gregory and Sister Anita, I want to hold you all over till we come out of the break. Let's bring Sister Tawan in to give us some words. Then we'll go to break. Then we'll come back with Brother Gregory and Sister Anita. Okay, let's go.
All right, Sister Tawan, assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam and happy Holy Day of Atonement.
Thank you. Happy Holy Day to you.
Happy Holy Day of Atonement to you.
I just wanted to speak as a sister who was at the Million Man March, but not in disobedience. I worked to help plan the march and all the planning in the march office as an MGT in Mosque Number 4. But also, I was a correctional nurse at the jail during that time. And I was able to get the brothers registered. I was so grateful when the minister announced at the march office that day. He had the press conference in the basement, and he was getting ready to end, and I couldn't ask the question. I guess he read my mind, because he turned around and said, oh, and we had registration forms to get the brothers and sisters incarcerated registered. And I was able to get so many of them registered for the march. Also, being a nurse, I was working on the grounds for the Million Man March. And I was there the morning when the sun rose, and those men rose up off the ground, like rising from the grave. I mean, it was just like, I said, oh my God, I'm looking at Ezekiel. Ezekiel in real time. Right. And but as the day went on, I was in a trailer, and I saw a ladder. You could climb up on top of the trailer. And I said, oh, my goodness, I'm going to go up and see that view from there. And when I did, it took my breath away. And as the men were coming, at one point when I was able to, when I got my break, because I was seeing, you know, people who were ill or, you know, things like that, that passed out or things like that. I would stand on the corner, and you could feel this energy. And I know it was Allah, because it was like an electrical energy, an electrical wave. I don't know if anybody else felt that.
Oh, yeah.
On those grounds that day. It was an electrical wave. And I said, yes, that's that electricity that WD started. That WD represents electricity, represents two things in electricity. And, oh my goodness, and it's like a sheath that keeps the electrical wires conducted so they don't just go all over the place. They're guided, you know?
Right.
So I think about WD Frog, and I thought about him and that electrical energy that day. It was so amazing. I just saw black men, and I saw, when they said a glimpse of heaven, I already said that when they put it in the paper. I already said it was a glimpse of heaven. When I stood on the corner, I said, this is what heaven's going to look like, and this is what it's going to feel like, and this is what you, when you say heaven, we already, this is it. This is it right here. And I had so much hope, and my daughter had special needs. And not only did we work, my daughter worked in the march office, and she had duties, and they trusted her, and she did a wonderful job. She had developmental disabilities, and she's deaf, and she did mailing, she did faxing, she did everything, and, you know, and we did whatever. And then at night, I would work during the day at the jail, and then I worked at the March office in the evening. And when I left the March office at night, I had to go to halfway houses because the brothers who were released to the halfway house, if they didn't get their TB test read, they would bring them back to jail and they would get lost in the system for months. Mm. So in order for them not to go back to jail, there's something I did on my own, which they didn't even know I was doing it. I would just take the cards of brothers who hadn't had their test read, and I would go to the halfway houses and find them. And after I leave the march office, because they couldn't go back to the halfway house until 10 o'clock. So I got them all cleared so they wouldn't have to go back to jail. And some of them were able to actually stand on the grounds of the march and be there because they didn't have to go back to jail. I mean, so... I'm gonna cut it short. But I mean, it was just so much.
We gotta run to the break real quick.
Okay, well, yes,
Sister Tawan, just hold on. Share that. Sister Tawan from Moscow 4, Washington D.C. She's on Straight Words tonight, calling in, and you can join the conversation too. 773-591-1690. We're gonna be back with more talk of the 29-year anniversary of the Million Man March, which is coming up on October the 16th, which is tomorrow, right here on Straight Words, WVON 1690, The Talk of Chicago.
Did you know on average every 2 minutes a woman is diagnosed with breast cancer? And one woman will die of breast cancer every 13 minutes. October is National Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Schedule a mammogram today.
Breast Cancer Awareness Month is powered by Equal Hope. Get the support you need for a healthier life. Call 312-942-9368 or visit equalhope.org.
The Talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.
I'm Vanessa Tyler.
And I'm Mike Stevens on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
It's go time.
He is too weak and unstable to lead America.
Vice President Harris and Donald Trump pulling out all the stops as more polls show a dead heat, a virtual tie in this neck and neck to the finish line.
The day I take office is finished.
Both candidates spending time in battleground Pennsylvania, a must win, as Harris continues her media blitz with plans to go on Fox News. And she taunted her 78-year-old adversary to let America see how he ticks.
He refuses to release his medical records. I've done it. Presidential candidate in modern era has done it.
Kamala Harris says her housing affordability plan will help generations of Black families.
When we address it by doing things like helping folks get their foot in the door with a down payment assistance, they will have the ability to be on that track of intergenerational wealth building.
In an exclusive interview with BIN commentator Roland Martin, the Democratic presidential candidate said Black folks have been denied the chance for home ownership due to a number of reasons. Harris says one of the main drivers is that neighborhoods are being systematically undervalued by real estate appraisers. Part of her plan includes up to $25,000 in down payment support for first-time homebuyers.
This close to election day, and polls show there are some Black men still not on board the Harris train.
I intend to earn the vote of everyone, including Black men.
Which is why her appearance on The Breakfast Club with Charlemagne the God in a town hall style event with questions from Black men is crucial, a constituency where Trump brags he's made some gains.
Black men, I love Black men. I love them. I love them. Gone through the roof with Black men. Black men. I don't do quite as well with Black women, I must say.
Those who were there telling Fox 17 the homecoming horror near TSU.
I heard gunshots and I took off running.
I thought it was just fireworks, but it ended up being gunshots. And everybody was just running. And I started running, almost fell. I just just thank God it wasn't me.
Tennessee police say it was a shootout near the HBCU in Nashville Saturday night when two groups pulled out their guns. One person, ID'd as 24-year-old Vonquay Johnson, died. Nine others hurt, including a 12-year-old. Police still trying to figure it all out. They say those who may know something are refusing to cooperate. On social media, stay connected with the BIN on Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok at Black Information Network. Catch us on X at Black InfoNet. I'm Vanessa Tyler with Mike Stevens on your home for 24/7 News, the Black Information Network.
Discover the captivating world of Black art and history at AfricanWorldArt.com. Are you seeking a unique and meaningful gift, or do you just want to come celebrate the richness of the Black diaspora? Our online gallery is the place for you with a wide selection of paintings, sculptures, prints, posters, and more. Journey through time with images that document our triumphs and challenges, from present-day icons to ancient civilizations, as well as the struggles of slavery, resistance, civil rights, the Black Power Movement, and the Black impact on sports, entertainment, politics, and global justice. AfricanWorldArt.com is more than just an online store. It's an inspiration drawn from our experiences. Visit AfricanWorldArt.com or call 267-312-4189. That's 267-312-4189. AfricanWorldArt.com. Since 1985, it's where Black fine art and historical pictures come to life. That's African spelled with a K. AfricanWorldArt.com.
Hi, it's Tavis Smiley inviting you to join me weeknight, 6 to 9 p.m. right here on WVON. I'll bring a national perspective to all things happening in Black America. It's talk the way you like it, and it's why America is listening.
It's the legendary Tavis Smiley, weeknights at 6 p.m. on the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
It's all about great food and service at Let's Eat to Live Restaurant, located at 621 East 67th Street on the south side of Chicago. Fresh, healthy, life-giving meals prepared with love. Veggies, fish, chicken, lamb, burgers, soups, breads, delicious desserts, and more. Some coming from our on-site garden in season. We got good food for your soul at 621 East 67th Street. That's Let's Eat to Live Restaurant. You can stop by or call us at 773-966-6549. Or visit the website letseattolivecafe.com.
Tune in every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. for Speak On It with Dr. Kofi Malik. You've seen him on cable TV. Now hear his spirited conversation on the Talk of Chicago. The question at hand is raising voices of the Negro. That plain and simple. Tune in every Wednesday night at 9 p.m. for Speak On It with Dr. Kofi Malik on the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
Life and power drives our weekly talk show. Straight Words on WVON 1690, The Talk of Chicago.
This is Naba'a Richard Muhammad.
This is Brother B.J. Murphy.
This is Brother James D. Muhammad.
Tune in Tuesday nights, 9 to midnight, for real Black talk. It's Straight Words.
On Straight Words, we inform, we educate, and we have a good time.
Black voices speaking on the Black struggle for freedom, justice, and equality, and bold defenses of the Honorable Minister Louis Farrakhan and the Nation of Islam. This Tuesday, 9 p.m. to midnight Central Time on WVON 1690 AM and WVON.com. And go to our website, straightwords.com, for more content. We're Black.
And we're strong.
We're unapologetically pro-Farrakhan.
Hey, Alexa, play WVON 1690 AM.
Getting WVON 1690 AM station from iHeartRadio.
Try it out for yourself. America is listening to WVON.
The views expressed on our programs are not necessarily those of WVON, Midway Broadcasting Corporation, or our participating sponsors.
The following is paid programming. The views are not necessarily those of this station. We are the Talk of Chicago, 1690 WVON.
All right, brothers and sisters, we Black strong, unapologetically pro-Farrakhan. You're listening to Straight Words on WVON 1690, the Talk of Chicago. Go to our website, straightwords.com, straightwords.com.
And you can check out some of our premium content, some of our previous shows that you may have missed. Good stuff, brothers and sisters. I mean,
and make a donation.
Yeah, yeah, and make a donation while you looking at and listening to the podcast and reading the stories. We need you to help us keep this good thing going. It's some good talk that you're hearing tonight. You ain't going to get it nowhere else but on Straight Words on WVON. So on our website, we have all the information that you need to make a donation, whether you Zelle, Cash App, PayPal, whatever system that you transfer money, we got it, or we can get it. All right. So also text us at 312-480-9775. That's our text line right now. You can hit us up, 312-480-9775. And Brother Naba'a standing by with that text line. He'll correspond with you right now. So we having a good conversation, brothers and sisters, about the Million Man March. You can join us, 773-591-1690, 773-591-1690. Tomorrow is the 29-year anniversary of that historic day, October the 16th, 1995. We were in Washington, D.C., and tomorrow is the 29th anniversary, and we're continuing our conversation. Sister Tawan, she's still on the line. She wanted to finish up, and then we'll go to our other callers. Go ahead, Sister Tawan.
Oh, yes, sir. I was just so excited because I'm just grateful to Allah to have the opportunity, and I wore so many hats during that time, but it was just it was an amazing time, amazing day. And I even took care of a man who was almost 100 years old, and he had a heart episode. And his son was so frightened. And he told his son, he was there on it, he told his son, he looked at him, he said, "Son, don't be afraid, because I waited for this day all my life. And if I die here, I'm already in heaven. And I have an angel." and he said, "Look, I have an angel." So he was so excited, and it was a little much for his heart. But, we were waiting for him to be transported. And it was just so much. It was just so much. But I loved the brotherhood of all the brothers. Yes, I remember with my daughter, and now they were saying something about the brothers, and she was saying the FOI, and somebody said, "They're not FOI." And she said, "Yes, they are. They just don't know it." And so she was watching, with my mom, and then they were telling me all the stuff she was doing. Mm. She was so excited. But she, as I said, my daughter has special needs, and I want to tell you this, is we would go up and down the East Coast when they had the men meetings, and we would be outside with, signs clapping, telling them to come on, brothers, come on. And we would just drive there with Carlos and sisters and encourage them to get in the men's meetings. And when we were in Baltimore, one of the men's meetings, my daughter had enough of those Jews, okay? So they were saying, "What do you want, Farrakhan?" And they had their signs, and they had all these things on the sign against the minister. And we were surrounding my daughter. We saw it, but after a while, we saw the mounted police galloping up the street. And one of the sisters said, "Oh my God, that's your daughter! They're going after your daughter." My daughter had climbed the lamppost and taking one of the Jewish men's signs and was hitting him over the head with it. And the mounted police came, and we had to explain, she has special needs. She don't know where she didn't know what she was doing. Where is it? She didn't know what she was doing. And then, she was deaf because she wasn't paying them no mind. And then she couldn't hear. I was telling her, "She can't hear you. That's what it is. Please," so they let her go. And when the newspaper came out, we thought we had her surrounded again. She was in the final call, and it was like the picture had pulled her out to the front. And we can see none of us, but she was right there in front, and with her picture in the final call, and then for that week. But it was just so funny. And I said, "Why?" I said, "Allah, how did that happen?" And I said, "Because she defended Minister Farrakhan. She said, 'Y'all stand over there.'"
Yes. Beautiful, sister. Beautiful story, sister.
All right, now.
Thank you, Sister Tawana.
Yes, so thank you. I just want to say thank you so much, and I want to encourage everybody. You know, Mrs. Farrakhan, you know, there was the spirit of atonement, the season of atonement. This is a season of atonement. But, you know, we have to keep atoning to one another and atone to ourselves. You know, just keep the atonement process, because I want to say this. Sister Aisha said in one of our on a program one day, and it stuck with me. She said, if we had been atoning all these years, we wouldn't need so much auditing.
That's right.
So this atonement thing is very important, and we must, you know, continue to repent. And as the brother said, the most important thing is for us to take care of one another.
That's right.
God has no need of us.
Yes, ma'am.
Or anything else, but to take care of one another. Thank you so much for letting me
share.
Lakem Salaam.
All right.
Brother
all right,
let's
Gregory,
bring Brother Greg
on.
In. Yeah, yeah,
Brother
Greg. Salaam
alaikum.
Alaikum salaam, sir. Thanks for calling in, man.
Shalom, Abargani, Hotep, Black Power, Black Liberation, Black Reparation, Black Repair. Let me tell you, brothers, it's so good to hear men choose stalwart soldiers for Muhammad that I have known so many years, man. Brother James GX, Brother Nabe, Brother Richard Muhammad. I mean, I love you all, man, so much, man. And I've had an opportunity to just be around you all doing the work, man, that led up to the most divine day in America. As far as I'm concerned, and I was really blessed, man, that day to be securing the lawn before anybody got out. It was me and Brother Ronald Muhammad, Brother Dennis Muhammad, Brother Jamil Muhammad, and Brother Thaddeus. We were there at 3:30 or something like that in the morning, securing before security even got there.
Were you up front by the stage?
We were on the stage, secured all of that area, the stage area, all of that. We held post until all of the officials and security and Supreme Captain, all of them got there. But we were blessed. We saw every single movement. We saw people way back there that was just coming from wherever they were coming from. And they were just sitting there, sleeping in the grass, leaning on a bench, waiting. They knew something magnificent was taking place, man. They knew it. And when I tell you, if just driving, we drove and driving every gas station, every store, all on the highway. All we heard was, I love you, brother. I love you, brother. Hugging brothers from every corner of the planet, every corner, brothers from everywhere. And I tell you, man, I know for a fact that God was present. Even on the highway, it wasn't even an accident. I mean, brothers, you can't tell me. And yeah, atonement. Yeah, reconciliation. But all of that was. And you know, it's so unfortunate. But yet we still see that, Will, our story, and the brother was right. It has to be told by us. And they know it was more than 2 million out there. They know it was more than 2 million out there, brother. I had so many amazing experiences. I worked at Protocol. And, you know, I so many. I tell you one of some funny stories. One was with the brother Donnie Simpson that used to be on BET.
Right.
Yes.
Ran into him in And in D.C., me and Brother Malik Farrakhan, you know, formed a Tony King.
Right.
So
right.
Me and Tony Malik, we were we went to a restaurant, and we ran into Donnie, and he was like, "Yeah, brothers, I want to come." And I said, "Well, find me, come up to the state." This brother, Donnie, found me. I saw him come through the. He got through that crowd. It was almost impossible. He did.
Yeah.
He
yeah.
got through. It was almost, I mean, impossible. And he got up there, but he had to use the washroom so bang. And he looked over at the porta-john, and it had to be 3,000 people per porta-john waiting to go in the washroom. I said 3,000 people look like waiting in the line. That's how many men was out there.
Yeah.
I took him into the Capitol. I let him hit security to let him up and took
right.
him into a watch room where he could go. He was so happy. You know, he was a
yeah.
big guy on BET.
Absolutely.
And we took care of him. And then, you know, Stevie Wonder. So I had to escort Stevie to the mic. And when I escorted Stevie Wonder, you know, he's supposed to, I think, go up there and just greet the crowd or say something. He wasn't scheduled to sing, I don't think, to my recollection. And anyway, he said to me, and Dennis was right there, but then he said, "Where was that band that was playing?" It was a band that had played. And me, I didn't break protocol. I was like, "Damn, Stevie want that band." And man, them brothers heard that. They just threw their tops off the instrument and put it back up. And Stevie bust out a song. Stevie bust out a song. Who gonna stop
him? Wow.
All right.
Let me tell you something, bro. Look, it was so many magnificent moments, but the divine presence cannot be even explained. I mean, that can't be. I did several shows many, many years ago on talk shows, and you know, even when I was hosted on VON, it was almost humanly impossible to tell people what happened that day. That day, when the sun came out and we looked across the Capitol,
yeah.
we looked, and I mean, just tears dropped.
Right.
And
we were
like speechless. And,
right.
and I mean, to the degree that it was, the sun was beaming, the weather was perfect, and brother, the spirit was deeper than anything people would have to tell you. That day, on that day, on that day, brother, men cry. On that day, men hug. On that day, men said, "I love you." On that day, men apologized. On that day, men were sending messages back home in every part of the universe and planet, telling their wives, their family, their children, their community, something is going on inside of me, and I can't wait to get home. And so, and look, long live the spirit of Reverend Bevel.
Yes.
Long live the spirit
boy.
Of all of those LOCs, all of those brothers and sisters that took part in the planning for the Million Man March. And long live the spirit, and may Allah be pleased with those that are not here physically with us that made a sacrifice, man, that made a contribution, you know, that did work, man. And I know the part that, you know, and long live Brother Wally, because he lived through you, James. He lived through you, Rich. Nabi, you know, I watched the ink, you know, before it dried. You all were writing, man, and on point with stories, man. And y'all contributions, brother, is in the book. May Allah continue to bless you all. But, man, let me tell you, I just, brother, you know, coming into the nation in 1982, I never thought that in 1995 that a vision like that, a dream or a miracle, as that brother said and everybody else, we would witness a miracle, brother. And, you know, we all was there when we saw the minister come in with security, but it was deeper than just coming in with security and going up to the mic. Bro, the whole world stopped. As much as they wanted to try to shut that down, and nobody, it was on a Monday, man, that the world stopped on a damn Monday. Bro, and they thought they could just suppress it and keep it quiet. And thank you, not CNN, but what you call it?
C-SPAN.
C-SPAN. Because C-SPAN didn't know. They was like, oh, we'll cover this. And boy, everybody around the country, they said, turn the C-SPAN. And other people, because, brother, they saw an ocean of black men. Ocean, and you could hear the voices of the men. Then I say this in closing. I walked off the stage and went through the crowd. I needed to, you know, feel that energy. I went all the way back and back. All I heard in there was love. I heard in there was they let everybody in. Nobody was like, you're on my toe. You're too close to me. Get off my feet. Everybody was like feeling secure. And you know that it, like the brother and the messenger said, our unity is more powerful than an atomic nuclear bomb. Well, on that day, brother, everybody on this planet know that's when you realize that the most honorable Elijah Muhammad, and thank you for all of what you've given and poured into our beloved, honorable brother Minister Louis Farrakhan, that really, really, really got us to this day across the sea. And bro, if God wasn't present, that was impossible. There's no way that you could get 50 of us there without some arguments, or 50 of us there without debating. And we had over 2 million black men, everybody in unity, everybody in love. And I understand the Negroes. I understand the, unfortunately, self-hatred. I understand all of that foolishness. But that day, even the ones who didn't show up, they regretted it. I've talked to them, brother. Brother, I've talked to so many. They say, I love watching them. The videos and hearing the minister speak, they said, but one thing I have to say, every time I see it, I cringe because somebody told me not to go and told me it was the Muslim. It was Christians there. It was Baptists there. It was Jehovah Witnesses there. It was Alphas there. It was Qs there. It was Kappas there. It was Elps there. It was Masons there. It was Hebrew Israelites there. It was Moors there. It was 5%ers there. It was everybody on the damn planet, black men every part of the planet. So I'm so thankful, man, that I lived to be there and lived to bear witness to one of the greatest moments in the annals of history.
That's right. That's right.
Go ahead, Brother Greg.
All right, Brother Greg. Thank you, man. Appreciate you. Assalamu alaikum.
Assalamu alaikum, Brother Greg. Yeah, Brother Nava, I was just curious, man. Is somebody else on?
Go ahead. Make your comment, brother. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
We keep saying it's one of the greatest moments in history. I'm trying to think of what's another moment that we would put up there with it, in the last couple hundred years, because I know, you say it was one of the greatest. It was the greatest. I mean, the March on Washington, 63, that was a great moment, but that was everybody, black, white, friends, enemies, everybody. I don't even know what other event would not that at the down other events, but what would match up to that other than, Ezekiel and the dry bones,
That's right.
Even, That was what the Bible was talking about.
An unequal event, brother.
Then, that was it, sir.
Yeah, an unequal event. Ain't nothing you can compare it to.
Not to me.
No, the only thing I could think of is maybe some of the events during Garvey's time.
But
none match the magnitude of. Yeah, you're right, Brother James. I don't think there's anything in our history that matches the magnitude of that day.
Because
it
was biblical. Yeah. It was prophetic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was what you read about in the Bible that was actually happening.
In front of your eyes.
In front of your eyes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I agree.
All right. We got Anita on, y'all, on WVON. Sister Anita, thank you for holding on. You're on Straight Words. Go right here, sister.
Hey, good evening. I've been here for an hour because we're an hour ahead here because I'm in North Carolina. So I didn't hear everything that was said, but I wanted to say this. Is Brother Richard on there?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't know you all voices. He is?
Yes, ma'am. This is him. How you doing?
Oh, okay. I heard you on the radio yesterday, Washington, D.C.
Oh,
W-O-L. I got a lot of history.
Nelson.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So this is wonderful. I said, I got to make sure I don't fall asleep. If I'm not on the phone, I usually fall asleep. Well, I always have to level. Okay. So this is the thing. The Jewish community did not accept Christ, from what I understand. So if you think you know everything and you connected to Abraham by blood, you can expect any dumb thing to come out their mouth. Okay, as you see, you know, the dominance, the perfection, they think they're perfect. They don't need to atone for anything. Okay, even though they do have their days, okay, that they're supposed to do it. All right. But if they forgot the Christ part of it, it's not going to stick, I don't think. So expect to almost just ignore them and go on with what Elijah Muhammad taught, not in a sense in a radical way, but in the sense that no one's going to live like a slave forever while you figure out your religion, the Jewish community, because we don't figure it out. We don't want to be slaves. And if that's what they want to be and always be in disobedience, that's on them. That's not on us. So don't take that personal. And I've always tried to defend us that position he had on the radio, but a lot of people being paid by the Jewish community, so they don't want to talk about it. So I just want to let you guys know this. And then I want to tell you that I live with a Nation of Islam person that grew up in Chicago. My husband, we divorced, but we had 6 beautiful children. And then he went on and married someone else, and her husband, she had 2 children, and they had 1 together. So he made sure all 9 of them finished college, and they went to major colleges, okay, like hard colleges, like Tufts, and a couple of my kids went to UNC. Okay, so all 6 of mine went, and then her 3 ended up going, and just one was his. Okay, I think this is like the last one he had with her, went to Morehouse. Okay, so Elijah Muhammad, his teacher, he graduated head of the class at the University of Islam at that mosque right there where, I don't know if it's called Mosque Mariam or not anymore, Chicago. Okay.
Yeah,
so it's like, let me tell you what it is experiencing Elijah Muhammad as a wife. She had the best of Christmas every day. There was nothing that brother didn't give us that he wanted to give us that Allah did not provide for him. And I did not work because he wanted me to stay home. And I breastfed for 2 years like the Islamic faith says. And it was difficult only in the sense that other women are not having children and, you know, doing that. So the knowledge was out of the system. So if you expect homosexuals to be your partner as a guy, you know, I guess it would be out of the system. Not saying Elijah Muhammad was like that, but let me tell you how this made me mad, Brother Richard. When you left off the radio yesterday, some guy called after that. He was the guest. And he said, I just don't see where Farrakhan is making anything beyond when he was 60. There's no progress. And it was, he was talking about all the black leaders saying it was no progress. And I'm like, how the heck he going to say that? I had Christmas every day. I had 4 sons in Chicago in that area that finished college. They went to schools with academic scholarships and things like this, the best schools, you know. And they had hard subjects, law, one was psychology. My daughters went too. My daughter's a doctor. All this is from this man being inspired by Elijah Muhammad. So don't tell me there's no future to the Million Man March. You guys got to let me know. Tell Minister Farrakhan, this family was the family that had Omar on the Nile, which was the non-alcoholic beverage of the community at the time, okay?
Yeah.
So, and before I tell people that, and they just almost die, and I'm going to keep saying it to let them know everybody ain't into alcohol and drugs and all that eating wrong and all that kind of stuff, you know? So there is a future. Well, I want you to know, Ismail Muhammad, he was tearing it up when he was on the radio. I don't know which day it was, but he was doing such a great job. And then when I listening to that dude on the radio yesterday, man, I'm like, you got to be kidding me. There's no future. I had Christmas every day, and that was my mother's favorite holiday. And she celebrated like I don't know what because she was a widow. She was probably glad that she had something to offer her children and, you know, had a good life for us. And my family respected, you know, Christmas in the right way. And so this is what I want you all to do. And my sister, she was doing some meetings in Alabama for community because I think Minister had told him to do some things in the community. Well, my sister was doing some things in Alabama, and they had involved Reverend Al Sharpton's brother, who had a, you know, like a prison ministry where he was trying to help people that were in and out of prison. So I just want you to know, Brother Richard, you need to talk to Carl Nelson about that guy that came on after you. He was ridiculous. I'm not going to say his name on the radio, but he was ridiculous how he just tore into the brothers like, well, I don't see anything, and why they think there's all that. But the guy that came on today, he corrected all Tyrone Powers. He corrected all that, and I called him. And he acknowledged, you know, Elijah Muhammad. He said they don't give him enough credit. Now, this is what I'm going to say, and I'm going to get off. Elijah Muhammad worked with the people overseas. There was no war, which means we had all our budget to work with here, okay? Elijah Muhammad had more wives. I guess they were all African-American because I didn't get into all of that. But who they trying to dump on you all now? All these immigrants here, they want you guys to take care of. And when they come out and work with you, they want you to train them when they get on these jobs. So they don't know how to work. They've been in the house all their, you know, all these generations, okay, and centuries. So you don't have to take care of them. Elijah Muhammad was ahead of his time. He was a premature. But on the ball, okay, he was ready way back then, and they ain't even got there yet, okay? So he didn't fight with the Middle East, which saved the country's budget. He went over there, came back with a plan and got black, or whatever he did, talked to the people from there. He got a plan and got black men off the street. They're shooting our black men because the white man don't want to accept. He never gave the black boys anything that after he raped the women. He never gave our boys anything. They raised themselves. Okay, all right. A child's going to raise himself and work to death for you. And then you make all the money and get them nothing for centuries. I mean, so what do you want them to do? What do you want them to act like? You? And then you're going to shoot them for what you did wrong? Elijah Muhammad fixed all of that. He dealt with the Middle East, and that's what he got out the Middle East. So what they see in the Middle East today is what they want to get out of it. Okay, so I wouldn't worry about none of them. Elijah Muhammad showed us how to peacefully deal with everything and take the best of whatever we learn or needed to help us get out of our bad conditions that slavery put us in. And he went forward, and he didn't think nothing of it. And I talked to Olive Muhammad, or I think it was Olive, said my granddad, I think he had a second or a third grade education.
Fourth grade.
He said he told me second or third. So, these white men got all kind of degrees, and what are they doing? They bombing people. The hurricanes are coming up where they have polluted the earth trying to dig for money and steal from the earth and from everybody. You know, Elijah Muhammad, we're going forward. We're not in that mud that the rest of the world is into, and you're right. You need another dimension other than the politics. And one more thing. Kamala was welcomed in the city of Chicago where Elijah Muhammad was, and he always protected women. So you just protect her like Elijah Muhammad. Let a woman be a woman, but he also had to be a man for her, too. Okay?
Yes,
and
ma'am.
That's how you deal with her. Okay? Don't be afraid of her or anything. You know, Elijah Muhammad said, you know, deal with her like she a woman. And that's how you deal with her, and you let her have her place of her excellence that she can perform. But at the same time, you know what I'm saying? She doesn't take over the leadership of men unless men just decide to throw it over. And even then, she still can't do it. But I had Christmas every day with Elijah Muhammad in my home, and I still have it, even though I'm divorced. And my grandchildren are doing just great, okay? I mean, my kids got PhDs and their master's degrees and things like that, and they know other skills too. And my grandchildren, I mean, they popping already, okay? And they still young, so... Don't let nobody tell you a dang thing, okay? Because Elijah Muhammad was it. And let Minister Farrakhan know it was the Omar Al Anou family wife. Because his other wife is deceased, the one came after me. That I got a history. Ain't nobody going to tell me there's nothing going on because I know better. And from the city of Chicago, those boys graduated from college, my four, okay?
Yes, ma'am.
So somebody telling a lie, and it ain't us.
That's right, sir.
All right. Yeah.
Thank you, sister.
With your bad self. Okay.
All right. Thank you, sister. All right. All right. So
go ahead.
All right, brother. Great, great testimonies tonight, man.
Yes, sir.
I really want to say I appreciate everybody calling in because we really wanted to hear from you all. So we got about 20 minutes now, so you can still
get
in.
The number out.
773-591-1690. I guess until then, brothers, we can give our testimony and tell our stories. Y'all got something y'all want to share?
Well, I know
I was going to say real quick, I wanted to play one cut from the Million Man March about the social benefit of our being together at the Million Man March. It's like a minute.
Yeah, go ahead. Well, you know, go on and do your thing, man. You do whatever you want to do with the clips.
Right.
Yes, you got a whole 20
minutes. That's it. It's going to run right into what Brother James is going to say, too. So go ahead, Brother Deontay, and play that clip number two.
Now, brothers, there's a social benefit of our gathering here today, and that is that from this day forward, we can never again see ourselves through the narrow eyes of the limitation of the boundaries of our own fraternal, civic, political, religious, street organization, or professional organization. We are forced by the magnitude of what we see here today that whenever you return to your cities and you see a black man, a black woman, don't ask him, what is your social, political, or religious affiliation? Or what is your status? Know that he is your brother. And if he needs help, you are obligated to help your brother because he is your brother. You must live beyond the narrow restrictions of the divisions that have been imposed upon us. Well, some of us are here because it's history making. Some of us are here because it's a march through which we can express anger and rage with America for what she has and is doing to us. So we're here for many reasons, but the basic reason that this was called was for atonement and reconciliation.
Beautiful.
Yes, sir.
Wow.
Beautiful. Yeah.
Wow. Wow. Go ahead, Brother James.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's so many things. As Brother Greg and everybody else has said, it is so many things that happened that day. Just some of the things. I would just, number one thing in my mind for us to remember, not just about the Million Man March, but to understand who the minister is with reference to scriptural identity, you know, where is he? Because this is more than just a man who called a march or a man who has done great social work, you know, as they often speak of Elijah Muhammad. It's much deeper than that. So I'll just leave that there. But on that day, you know, I remember we had the media mobile homes out in a
trailer
further down the mall. It was further down. So late at night. And as brother said, you hear the Johnny call out. And when you come out, as the sun comes up, thousands and thousands of people, so many that I was had to get up to the stage and I couldn't get up there. There was no way around. And you know how wide that expanse is all the way.
Yeah, man.
If you have to walk all the way around to the front of the Capitol, I couldn't even see how to do that. So I had to start. It was like walking into a wall of peanut butter, trying to squeeze through the brothers. And because I had on my FOI uniform on, somebody said, let the minister through, let the minister through. Not Minister Farrakhan, but, you know, they just probably call all the brothers ministers. And so the brothers lifted me up. You know, as you from the front where the stage was down that little side where there's a wall that goes all the way down to the fountain almost. They lifted me up and started passing me over. I'm laying on my back and they're passing me up to the front. And that's how I got to the front of the place, man. And as you say, you know, that was just one real memory I had. And but the other feet that we really need to examine and study, and maybe there's a book somewhere that needs to be written, is just the organizing effort. I think, I forget who was in charge of transportation, there were people in charge of logistics, and was we were all Sam working
Jordan?
Out of,
was that Sam Jordan and Brother Ernest? Muhammad?
Thought about Ernest.
Sam Jordan worked out of the mayor's office.
Yeah, and we have, you know, the Sigma House, and forever thankful for the for our brothers in the Sigma fraternity. They opened up their house that we could operate from. I mean, that was a buzz of activity coming out of that place, man. And we spent, I don't know how much you went down there, Brother Naba, but we spent weeks down there. We had our office, the D.C. office, I believe, still at that time. We were working up out of that, man. It was just a magnificent time, man. Magnificent time. And then, you know, as you look at the videos, you see all the signage. Brothers raising the signs, identifying themselves, you know, who they are and what messages. Black power messages, love messages. It was just an overwhelming event, man.
That's powerful. I want to do one thing. We've been talking about atonement. I want to say, one beautiful article in the Final Call this week about the Million Man March, about lessons from the march, about great things. You want to get that at finalcall.com. And I want to share something with you, and you can get this from finalcall.com. Also, these are the 8 steps of atonement, because this is a process, a process that you can work to reconcile yourself to others. And ultimately what we want to do is reconcile ourselves to one another and ultimately recognize ourselves to God. Because how can you say you love God who you have never seen and hate your brother who you see every day? These are the 8 steps of atonement. Step number 1, someone must point out the wrong. Step number 2, acknowledgement of the wrong. Somebody points it out, I acknowledge that I was wrong. Confess the fault, first to Allah God, then to those you have offended. Step number 4, repentance. A feeling of remorse or contrition or shame for past conduct, which was wrong and sinful. Step number 5, atonement. Meaning to make amends and reparations for the wrong. Step number six in the process of atonement, forgiveness by the offended party, to cease to feel offense and resentment against one another for the harm done. Step number 7 in the process of atonement, reconciliation and restoration, meaning to become friendly and peaceable again. Step number 8 of the 8 steps to atonement. Perfect union with Allah God and with each other. You can get that too at finalcall.com. And the stuff about the Million Man March. And my editorial this week about lessons. from the Million Man March that we need to apply today. All right, brothers, y'all got it.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
But you know, I'm going to tell you, I love that pivot point. The pivot point in the 8 steps of atonement is number 4 of repentance, because the minister explained that the repentance means that you've got to turn away from a behavior that you know is incompatible with the will of God. You know it is. You got to stop it where it is, and that is on the road to healing right there, and just acknowledging that I'm doing something that I know I shouldn't be doing. It's not in God's will for me. Let me put this away and get to the fifth stage, which is atoning. And then I got to do something about what I have done in the past to make things better for myself and the person that I've been dealing with. I got to prove that I changed. And that's what we got to do, black man. And then you get that forgiveness, though. That was the sweet spot, is that forgiveness, you know.
Yeah,
you got to repent first.
That's one of the difficulties in this day and age of social media. You know, when you see stuff on social media, people know what they're putting up for the world to see. Is like you say, is wrong, is incorrect, but they do it anyway for the sake of getting clicks, or I guess maybe making them a few dollars because they get an audience from it. So in this day and age, it's like promote evil, like the Minister Smith said, it's fair seeming. You know, it's promoted these days. And so, you know, you're fighting against the tide when you try to do right. But we have to do right.
That's right. That's it.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I tell you, brothers, you feel better doing right.
Yeah.
I tell you that. Just trying to be right.
Mm-hmm.
You feel better within yourself when you can sleep and know that you have not harmed anyone.
Mm-hmm.
You can walk a little more peacefully.
Yeah.
When you know you have not harmed anyone or injured anyone. So, of course, you got to be aware of the evils in society.
Yeah.
But you don't have that looming thought in the back of your mind that somebody's coming for you.
You don't have to look over your shoulder.
Not like that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I wanted to say one other thing real quick. In terms, we had Sister on, and she talked about the Sister Robin on, and she talked about the challenges of dealing with her students as a teacher. And I've actually been to her school in Randallstown, which is like right outside of Baltimore, like literally you cross the street, you're in Randallstown section of Maryland, section of Baltimore. And what she was talking about was the way that these lesson plans are structured. There's certain things that she has to teach. And I know that these phone addictions and these are serious things that we have to deal with if we want to correct our children. How can your child go to school with a phone and ain't worried about somebody calling you because they did something wrong with the phone?
Right.
Where'd that come from?
Right.
Where'd that come from? So there's responsibility that we have to take for our children and for the education of our children. And the thing that really I feel that bothers me so much is that we have children coming out of all kinds of circumstances and negative conditions. And we feel like when we drop them off at school, they should forget all that. So you don't have counselors to deal with the students. You don't have medical professionals to deal with their health. You don't have nutritionists to deal with their nutrition. You don't have behavioral scientists to deal with their behavior. You don't have people that are actually helping the family cope with whatever the family has to cope with. So I bring that back to one of the themes of the Million Man March, responsibility. We as parents and we as a community have to take charge for the education of our children. We have to hold people accountable, but it starts with us. And my feeling is, I tell you this, brothers, when you start working on something and it's somebody else's job and they getting paid for it, you'll do your work, but you're going looking for the person whose job it is. Because you want to know what they're doing. If I'm doing this and I'm not getting paid, and you are getting paid, now you're going to have to do a better job, and I'm going to be here with you to make sure you do it. But those values of atonement, those principles of atonement, reconciliation and responsibility.
Yeah, but in many ways, too, like that community that you just spoke of, or that village, as we used to say, has kind of broken down with the advancement of time. You know, there used to be where you could trust your neighbor.
Mm-hmm.
In many communities these days, we've got so confined to our own little worlds that we may sometimes not know. You may know your next-door neighbor a little bit, but you don't know the one next to them. And then, you know, you can't really trust the mental state of mind of some folks to even want them to be able to help keep your child in order, because you don't know their mental state, you know, with the abuse and stuff that's going on. So there's just so much in our community that we have to work on. But like was being said earlier, everybody just got to do something. You know, like we said, like Minister Ishmael said yesterday, you know right from wrong, it's your nature. We got to get back to our nature and get away from what we've adopted as a way of life that has been given or demonstrated to us through this system that the Caucasian has built for himself.
Yeah,
a couple of months ago.
So we got a divorce, a separation, I guess, is what I'm saying.
Yeah. So a couple of months ago, we had a brother that was on the show. He talked about the black community. We need a revolution of love in the black community. And sometimes, you know, you be waiting for people to feel the same way you feel about doing something like that. So you talk about rekindling the spirit of the Million Man March. You do it tomorrow. You do it tomorrow by yourself.
Right.
And you take it upon the responsibility that every black person that you see, I'm going to treat them with so much kindness and love. I'm going to inject the spirit in them when they come into contact with me. And you create, like my brother, Brother Greg, we talk about, it was the most divine day in America. Make one, damn it. Make it a divine day by imposing your will of the spirit of God on everybody that you come into contact with.
Mm-hmm.
You show them that you're the first one to speak. You're the first one to offer some kind of service to help your brother and sister. So it starts with one person. So don't wait for nobody to join on. You know what I'm saying? You start.
Mm-hmm. And if you look at that day as a macrocosm, or would it be the micro, you know, the smallest element of it, it didn't just happen. That one day didn't just happen overnight.
Right.
It was kind of mentioned earlier. It was a process. It started, like you said, with one man, but that one man generated a vibration and electrical current that started attaching to other people, first with the nation, but the nation, people in the nation then spread it to others. And month after month after month, it built up a reality where people were kind of on the same wavelength. And it just culminated in that day. So if you can do it for that process, for that 1 year to turn out one day, what I guess everybody, you know, we have to admit what didn't happen is, and the minister gets the blame for something that he's not responsible for, because he told us all what to do.
Right.
We have to take the responsibility of atoning for not doing what he had asked us to do. He laid out a big, very big program that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad already has, that he just laid on top. If we had just done what he asked us to do as a community, as a nation of people, you know, like somebody said, we wouldn't be needing to get, you know, we wouldn't need to be getting examined. Our heads examined today.
You know? Right.
We'd be already on our way, But here we are.
And
let's just real quickly, though, what also happened was there was another force involved, and that was what was Allah doing. As we move down the line, you know, as we look at these wars and this whatever happens at the election, what is Allah doing in this process as well that's making things happen and changing hearts and minds? So.
Yes, sir. Yeah, and what we have to do, basically, Brother BJ, the other thing I want to say real quick, the minister started planting seeds for the Myanmar March that happened in 1985.
Yeah.
By going around the country talking to black people. He didn't even know.
Yeah.
And when he called for the Myanmar March, and nobody worked harder to make it a reality, he didn't know that Allah had blessed him by being a diligent servant. Allah had blessed him to plant the seeds, and when the time was right, we just had to harvest. Go ahead, Brother BJ. Mm.
Go ahead. But brothers and sisters, you can get all the replay of this great 3-hour conversation about the Million Man March. By the time you wake up tomorrow, you can go to straightwords.com, straightwords.com, and we're praying that you will be so inspired by what you heard tonight and what you hear on our platform that you will be inspired to give a donation of a Million Man March. That's worthy of a Million Man March. Maybe you got $1 million. I don't know.
That's right. Brother BJ.
Somebody might drop. Don't man, stop. This is. I'm so inspired. I might drop $1 million on these brothers to make sure that this never stops. We need this in the city of Chicago. We need this all over the world, what we talked about tonight. So go to our website, straightwords.com. Straightwords.com. Give from your heart, brothers and sisters. Call our text line. Hit us up on the text line, 312-480-9775, 312-480-9775, straightwords.com. For all of our producers, Brother Deontay, Sister Jeanette, back in Charlotte, we thank y'all so much. For Brother James G. Muhammad, for Brother Naba'a Richard Muhammad, and Brother BJ, we pray that we'll be back here with you not tomorrow, but next Tuesday. 9 p.m. sharp. Make sure you're in front of your radio on WVON 1690, The Talk of Chicago. We love you, brothers and sisters. And when you see us, we're going to prove our love for you.
That's right.
On straightwords.com. Make sure you go to the website and support us. Thank you, brothers and sisters. Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum
salam.
Wa alaikum
salam.
Did you know for women in the United States, breast cancer death rates are higher than those for any other cancer besides lung cancer? October is National Breast Cancer Awareness Month. Schedule a mammogram today.
Breast Cancer Awareness Month is powered by Equal Hope. Get the support you need for a healthier life. Call 312-942-9368 or visit equalhope.org.
The Talk of Chicago and the voice of the nation is 1690 WVON, Berwyn, Chicago.